The views expressed on the previous programs are those of the hosts, guests, and callers, and do not reflect those of the Beasley Broadcast Group, its staff, advertisers, or agencies.
Joe Bell is the Antichrist.
The biggest names, the best talent.
Jesse Engel will be a great voice of
You're listening to Sports Radio 560 WQAM. Miami, Fort Lauderdale.
So? 560 WQAM sure. presents The Neil Rogers Show. To talk to Neil, dial 567-0560 in Dade and Broward. In other counties, call toll-free 877-785-NEIL or pound 560 on your AT&T and Verizon wireless phones.
Fact, you know,
the opinions expressed by Neil. His guests or his callers do not represent those of WQAM management, staff, or sponsors. Now, the Neil Rogers Show on 560 WQAM.
The Yellow Express is working.
It's Friday, you bastard.
Hey, y'all. It's Britney Spears with another blog update. Well, I'm here with my new boyfriend. He's a backup dancer on my tour.
What up?
And we're about to watch an important speech from President Obama. Turn on the TV, babe.
All Americans have much to be proud of. Our armed forces are stronger than ever. The economy is getting back on track. And Britney Spears is hanging up. Yes, sir.
Did I hear what I think I heard? The economy is back on track? That's awesome!
Señorita Britney?
Oh, hi, Consuela. She's my housekeeper, y'all.
Sí, Señorita Britney. Yo tengo un mensaje más importante.
English, please, Consuela.
Oh, lo siento. Your p*** is hanging out. Gracias.
Dang! I didn't even know she spoke English.
Babe, I think she said your p*** is hanging out.
OMG, so embarrassing! Let me step this back in. Okay, that's it for today's vlog. TTYL, y'all!
TTYT, it's Good Friday, wow. And Pesach. Desperate. Now, the red light is on, but I guess that's going to be on there forever until Eric rejiggers that thing, whatever.
Yeah, I just checked the streaming. It's working fine.
Streaming is working fine. Oh! Outlook Express is working fine. Oh! Nothing is coming in on it, but it's working fine. Well, yeah, I don't know where you're... We got Flea here again today, and then Flea and George next week. I'll be on vacation, and the week after that, me and George.
All right.
That's just the way it is, Jolly Joe Bell. They have taken a paring knife. You know what a paring knife is?
Yes.
And they have scalped the show as much, and it's down to the bare bones. We used to have a three-person show. Now it's a two-person show, and one of these days it's going to be an automated show. And remember what I was telling you yesterday? And now I'm more positive than ever. They would kiss the ground. Joe Bell would clean up 4,000 turds if they could get me to take a walk.
I don't know about that.
Oh, yeah. I'm telling you. They want out of this deal. Oh, we're paying them all that money. How about if I take another 50% pay cut and then another one? How about if I pay them to do the show? How would that be?
Go ahead.
Yeah. I think that's what eventually is going to come down to. How much will you pay us to be on the air? That's the new wave of radio. How is it that everybody all of a sudden went bankrupt? I just don't understand it. Nobody's got any money. Just all of a sudden we woke up one day and, oh, it's a depression and everybody's broke and nobody's buying any houses or cars and everybody, GM, is out of business. And I just don't get it.
Yeah.
Do you understand it?
No, not really.
I mean, I don't claim to know much about economics, but Jesus, God.
It's all those toxic loans.
That's right, the toxic loans. All them people that couldn't be affording no houses.
I think it's more like the toxic people.
I think it's a toxic world in which we live. But here we are, it's a Friday. Happy Good Friday. You don't say Happy Good Friday, do you?
I don't know. I guess you
happy
just say
Easter.
Good Friday to you.
Yeah, Good Friday. Good day. Paul Harvey used to say, good day. Paul Harvey Jr. used to say, good day. We don't hear from him anymore.
No.
Let's take a look at the skeleton schedule. Big O, 2-4. Geldy, 4-7.
Ow!
For Mad Dog. Everybody's Catholic today, except us. And then we got the Beast from 8-11. And then Greg Don't Like Us, 11-1. What's that all about, Greg Likens, on this Friday night?
I'm not sure. I think just to give him a show to try to get his chops going, I guess.
Well, I don't understand. All these budget cuts and everything, and we still got a guy on. Come on, slap on that ESPN radio. I don't know the guy. Maybe he's great on the air. I doubt it.
He's a nice guy.
Is he great?
I wouldn't call him great on the air. Nobody's a nice guy.
Is he
guy.
Good enough to replace Joe Zagacki?
Well.
Well, what?
I can't comment on that.
I ain't seeing much?
Yeah.
I would agree with that. Joe Zagacki is just grotesque. grotesque at best. Okay, let's take a look at the poll. Now, let me just see something. I sent Eric a poll for the weekend. And, oh, there it is. My favorite Easter candy is blank. Ooh. You know what I love?
What's that?
Are those Cadbury Easter eggs.
Oh, yeah, those are good.
Oh, my God. I could eat a whole bag of those.
Yeah, and I'm big on the marshmallow peeps.
The marshmallow peeps. We're back to that again.
Yep.
Flea is into the peeps. How's the peeping, Tommy? Now, did you see The Talented Mr. Ripley?
Yes, I did.
Remember that line by Philip Seymour Schwartz? How's the peeping, Tommy?
Mm-hmm.
That was a good movie.
Yeah, it was.
It was a little bit
gay,
but nevertheless. Oh, here's somebody who says, Happy Easter, and that's it, from JCS. Well, what we do, why are you sending me Happy Easter? An old Jew fag like me, Happy Easter? And I don't even want Happy Pesach. I don't participate in this stuff. Have a good time. Roll out the Easter eggs. Get the Easter bunny going. And don't be buying no bunny. They had a thing on the news here last night about people that buy, like, little cute little bunnies for the kids. And then mm-hmm. the bunnies get to be big rabbits, you know, wabbits. And they're a pain in the ass, and they drop those nasty. You have to call Joe Bell. We'll give you his email address a little later on. He'll come and clean up the rabbit turds. Well, I'm a lot less messy than what he cleaned up the other day.
I'm sure it is.
I mean, rabbit turds are like bullets. They're like BBs, large BBs.
He told me there was even feces on the wall. I'm like, how did it get on the wall? He's like, I don't know.
Oh, remember that song by the Statler Brothers, Feces on the Wall? Down, 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 down. Yeah, Feces on the Wall. It's one of my favorites. He told you that, huh?
Yep.
So, in other words, you guys had a heart-to-heart conversation about his turd-cleaning episode the other day?
Yeah.
I'm telling you, that's his calling in life. He finally found it. And after the call I got from him yesterday, which I'm not going to go into on the air, but nevertheless, after that phone call, I've decided that I've tripled my efforts. I'm going to outlive that bastard if it's the last thing I do. I'm going to dance on his grave, and then I'm going to pee on it.
Wow.
Then I'm going to take down my pants and drop some real serious turds, which he won't be able to clean up. And just leave them there for eternity. As they turn to stone, the petrified turds on Joe Bell's grave. Oh, God, would that give me sexual pleasure to dance on his grave? Evil person. Good friend of yours, though, so I don't understand that whole deal. How long are we going to let the silence go?
I was waiting for you to break it.
No, maybe I'll break wind.
Oh, don't do that.
I'm breaking the silence.
As long
so
as
we're streaming. Everything is copacetic. Let's make sure. Let's see if the outlook is working. I know it is, because I got a couple of things, including one from our old friend Jeff Cohen. Let's see. Michael Hartman says, Good Friday to you, Neil. Well, what does that mean? Is this what you people are down to now? And it's a picture of a long pier. I don't know what that's supposed to be. Yeah, maybe that's a message for Joe Bell. Only in his case, it ought to be a short pier. Take a long walk off a short pier. He just really frosts my ass. He's just obnoxious. I was just walking into Woodbine yesterday at 3 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
and my BlackBerry rings, and I saw the number on there. Oh, no, not Joe Bell. And as always, every call from him is a downer. Every one. Never like any good news, anything positive. It's always a downer. Go away, Joe. Go slice and dice some other show. Go stab somebody else in the back.
I'm surprised you answered it.
What do you mean you're surprised I answered? Why not?
I don't know. You're walking into Woodbine. You see that call. I think I might just let it go to voicemail. That's just me, though.
And then we got disconnected, and I actually made an attempt to call him right back, but he called me right back, so he beat me to the punch. It was windy. The wind was blowing, and I should have been knowing if I saw that number. The most negative person I've ever encountered in my life. During good times, bad times. When are the good times of this place? Last 2.5 years since he's been around, they've been all bad times, straight downhill. I'm not blaming him for the economy, but nevertheless, why not? Now, when's Jesse Agler starting doing the voice of Canes the sports?
I don't know.
Well, you said that before the show this morning. You think Jesse would be a hell of a lot better than the crap we got now. I don't want to get you in trouble with Clarence, though, because no. I know he's a butch boss. He'll come and grab your ass. So here's a, this is, I think, the only one we got this morning from Jeff Cohen. Well, we got those ones saying happy, Good Friday or whatever it says. You know, good, yeah, Good Friday. Now let me try to get it straightened out. Good Friday, isn't this the day that Christ was crucified?
I think so.
So what's good about it?
I don't know.
And then Easter Sunday, isn't that the day he rose from the dead?
I believe so.
Oh, boy, what a story. What a Bubba Micey. My God. Good morning, Neil. Happy Passover, says Jeff Cohen. And back to you, Jeff. Just a note to say hi and happy Passover. As usual this time of the year, I'm busy with the pizza loft, matzo lasagna, and Passover pizza. Mm-hmm. The matzo pizza. I try to keep up with you when I'm at work, but I'm not in my office much where the internet and radio are. Dove keeps me up to date. Always listen when I'm in the car. By the way, we sold 14 certificates yesterday. I forgot to tell you all about that before the show. Well, can't do it now.
No.
Well, no, I knew that was going to happen. It was a limit of one, and it was, you know. The last 2 weeks in a row, it's been set up as kind of like guaranteed failure. We got to pick a pony at Gulfstream later on at 1:45. We got Craig as our contestant, and I'm picking in the second race the one, Nicole Song, with Javier Castellano. Jeff says, this is the week where we see a lot of customers from the old days, and you come up on a regular basis. A lot of talk about the days of remotes and personal appearances, how you put us on the map, and how often I see you with the loft. Rimmer called when his team was in town, but didn't make it in. Have a great weekend and hope to see you on your next visit. Your loyal friend. Thanks for everything over the last 35 years. Jeff at the Pizza Loft.
Mm.
Which is a not too subtle way of reminding people that every year at this time he does the matzo pizza and the matzo lasagna. And
yeah, let me tell you, his garlic knots are the best.
Garlic what?
His, like, garlic knots? The garlic rolls? Oh, they're so good.
Garlic knots?
Some people call them knots, some people call them rolls.
No, nobody calls them knots. Garlic rolls. Nobody calls them knots.
I've heard knots.
Garlic roll. Knots.
He's got the best knots. Garlic rolls ever.
In my lifetime, I never heard that expression, garlic knots. Where'd you come up with that?
They call that
probably
Tampa.
Tampa.
Yeah.
Probably a Tampa thing.
Sure is.
Probably all the goyim over there. Oh, them garlic knots are wonderful. Yeah, he does have phenomenal garlic rolls.
See, you almost
maybe
said
he'll
nuts.
Bring in some matzo pizza, you and George next week. Keep that in mind.
Okay.
Because he does occasionally still, even though the sales department pissed him off and chased him away, he still occasionally spends a few bucks. And hopefully he's doing well. Thanks, Jeff. Good hearing from you. So we got Wayne Arnold is back open business, and Jeff Cohen is still doing it.
Skim Mandich, I f***ed him. Oh!
Do you have an ugly two-year-old? Of course you do, because all two-year-olds are ugly, unless they've had the necessary plastic surgery and beauty treatments. At Desperate Parents Plastic Surgery, we can help. You see, now is the time to keep your toddler from going down the path of ugliness, like preemptive anti-wrinkle injections, chemical peels, preteen B-cup breast implants, butt enhancers, and collagen lip procedures.
When our Jenny started walking, her stubborn baby fat convinced us that liposuction in her formative years would help her experience all the psychotic vanity we've enjoyed all our lives.
So what are you waiting for? An FDA approval? Don't let that stop you. Call Desperate Parents Plastic Surgery today and have your toddler shake that moneymaker tomorrow. Please make sure your child is no longer on a pacifier, as this could impair the healing of the collagen lip procedure.
1017 at 560 WQM. Happy Good Friday or unhappy Good Friday or happy Pesach or whatever, all this other stuff. A lot of crap going on. A lot of people traveling. Mm-hmm. Nobody on the roads. Roads are wide open. Nobody at the QAM today. The place is vacant, I'm told.
Very empty.
Very empty. Is Joe Bell there today?
Yeah, I saw him earlier.
Did you really? No mm-hmm. wonder you sound a little bit down.
And Clarence is here, too. I just saw his bag.
Oh, my God. Well, he can't be Catholic, you know?
No.
Good Jew boy like Clarence, he can't be Catholic. What kind of a name is Darrow, anyway?
I don't know.
Doesn't sound Jewish to me.
Not really.
Maybe he's make-believe Jew like you are.
Yeah, could be.
Here's the poll from yesterday. I just changed it, by the way, and I put the one about the Easter candy on there, but Charlie B. left off my favorite.
What's that?
Which is the Cadbury eggs, which is not the Cadbury cream-filled eggs. It's the Cadbury, the little hard candies.
Okay, I'll put that on there.
What?
I'll put that on there.
Cadbury eggs. Don't know what it is. People who are really connoisseurs of Easter crap. Here's the poll from yesterday. If I could spend an hour with someone from my past, it would be. We had 664 votes. Pretty weak, but then again, look at the time of the year, baby. And look at that show we had yesterday. A technical disaster. A disaster. Kind of like a phone call from Joe Bell. It's always a disaster. An ex-girlfriend or boyfriend, 192, if I could spend an hour. My father, 169. An old friend, 109. My mother, 102. Now, that's interesting because we have a largely male audience, most almost entirely, and yet, I don't know. The mothers are, like, way behind here, dragging behind. Generally, guys have bad fathers and good mothers. Or just crappy parents, you know. My ex-spouse, 23. A former teacher, 20. A sibling, 20. An ex-boss, 14. Oh, that sounds good. Where's Greg Reed when we need him? He's starting to look really stellar in retrospect. My shrink, 7. My old priest minister, or Rebbe, 6. And a former coach, 2. Former coach. Hey, coach. Hey, coach. That whole coach thing, man, that just leaves me wild. All these coaches for life. You know, the Bear Bryant crowd and Woody Hayes, all those other Farbissen, just obsessive. Don Shula. There's an, oh, you can't knock the shoes, Meister. I mean, if these people weren't coaching football, what else would they be doing? Can you answer that question?
No, not really.
Bobby Bowden. There's a real yahoo for you. Steve Spurious. Real ass clown.
Mm-hmm.
Andre says, Neil, is Joe the ugliest human alive? People are picking on Joe Zagacki now.
Joe Zagacki sucks, okay?
Okay, it says he looks like a mutant. He looks like one of the mutants from the movie The Hills Have Eyes 2. Says Harvey Wallbanger in West Park. Well, Harvey, I don't think Joe Zagacki is the ugliest human alive, but no. He is old penis face. I think that was Flea that coined that expression, penis face, for Joe Zagacki, wasn't it? Oh, that's right. You're not supposed to criticize him. I forgot. Now, did that discussion really take place, or is that a joke?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah. what a place. Clarence defending Joe Zagacki. That's because Joe is his mentor, you do understand. I mean, Clarence is such a putz, he probably really believes Joe belongs on the air. But then again, it's the Canes, baby. It's the Canes. It's that whole fraternity of silly people. Only one thing I can say about that.
Oh, my! 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 Oh, my!
Now, why are we picking on Joe Zagacki on Good Friday?
I don't know.
Yeah, Baron Fitz says, happy anniversary of some dude getting nailed to a cross. Let's celebrate. I don't know. I don't want to, like, start picking on people's holidays because they're all full of crap. All the religious holidays and all the religions are all full of crap. Wait till I get to the story in a second here about the Archbishop says, pending report to show Irish priests abuse thousands of children. Not hundreds, not dozens, thousands of children. Aaron says, Aaron, I don't know too many goyim named Aaron, do you?
No.
Aaron says, I believe the proper Good Friday greeting is Blessed Good Friday. I'm just guessing because this is what someone posted on my Facebook this morning. Are you still Twittering, by the way?
Here and there, just for the station, not for me so much.
Just for the station?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
The station has a Twitter.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Well, this show's got a Twitter, too, but it's not. It's unauthorized. It's fake. We also have a Facebook, also fake. We have a MySpace, but nobody writes on it anymore, so, you know.
Yeah.
Nobody loves us anymore. That's okay. I can handle it. I can deal with it. Got a nice vacation coming up. It's starting at 2 o'clock, and I'm going to make the most of it. I'm thinking, and I'm just telling you, remember the moment, 10:22 a.m. Friday, April 10th.
Okay.
I might just disappear.
For good?
Yeah, never be heard from again. I'm just telling you, different things go through your mind, okay? Here's one from Vince. The alleged reason for the name Good Friday is because it's the day Jesus Christ died for our sins. Oh! I'm not interested in Easter either, I say. More gay stuff, says Vince in Jacksonville. Do you think this guy is hot? I think spending some time with him would make for a Good Friday. And he's got a picture of a guy. No, not even lukewarm.
No.
No. But good luck to you, Vince. Have a good time. Make it a Good Friday. Oh, Ray says, happy Passover Easter. When I was growing up, my Fakakta family celebrated everything. Whenever Easter fell during Passover, I always got kosher for Pesach candy in my Easter basket. Evidently, it was okay to celebrate Easter as long as we didn't eat chumetz. No wonder I'm spending so much money on therapy, says Ray. Yeah, those religionists, they'll do it to you every time. Al Dente says, Defo is appearing at the Al Casino this afternoon. Just thought I'd tip you off, clue you in, put you in the loop, give you the buzz, put a bug in your ear, put you on notice, lay it on you. Hope to see you there, Al. Yeah, we really care about Defo.
Yeah.
And his big number.
Oh!
0.3. What's the point, Defo? Dana, who's a guy. Now, Dana can be... I'm trying to think of that singer, Dana. Oh, it's a long time ago. Nobody will remember. There was Bill Dana.
My name, Jose Jimenez. Remember Bill Dana?
No. Way before your time.
My name, Jose Jimenez.
But anyway, Dana says I'm a guy. I was talking to my roommate about Good Friday. We agreed it's nothing to celebrate. Damn the ass-founds that talk bad about George. George is cool. Have a great weekend, guys. Loving the show, says Dana. And by the way, I'm a guy. Yeah, we believe you, Dana. A guy with a vagina, but nevertheless. Oh, we got 28 votes on the new poll.
All right.
My favorite Easter candy is Cadbury Cream Eggs, 8. Chocolate Bunnies, 5. Hershey Kisses, 4. Hershey Kisses are Easter candy?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Get out of here, Charlie B. Charlie, you be crazy. Hershey Kisses are Easter candy? My ass. Marshmallow Peeps, 4. I bet you voted for that.
I did.
Melted Chocolate Easter Eggs, or a Malted Chocolate Easter Eggs, 3. Jelly Beans, 3. I Can't Eat Any, 2. Cadbury Eggs, 1.
You know what we're missing is the pastel M&Ms.
Gummy Bunnies, none. Marshmallow Easter Eggs, none. Marshmallow Easter Eggs have none? The what? The pastel M&Ms? What does that mean, pastel?
They come in like the fall Easter colors, the light blue, the pink.
They put Easter M&Ms.
Okay.
And what is it about Jesse Agler and Joe Zagacki that you want to tell the audience?
I don't know anything about that.
It's Friday, you bastard.
Special reason I'm playing that, just I haven't played it in a long time, and I likes it. You know what I mean? I likes it.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks to Paul, who sent me the name Vic Dana. That's who I was thinking of, the singer. You remember Vic Dana?
No.
I'll tell you one thing. He looked pretty good. And he sang, you know, Red Roses for a Blue. Of course, everybody sang that. Lady. Bobby Vinton sang that. Who else sang that? Red Roses for a Blue. Andy Williams sang it, I think. Remember Andy Williams?
Oh, yeah.
One thing about Andy, he went away. He's got his golf tournament, I guess. Is he still alive, Andy Williams? Well, I sure hope so.
I don't know.
He's the one who gave us the Osmonds. Remember the Osmonds?
Oh, yeah.
I want some.
I want.
Is that Vic Dana?
It is.
Oh.
Red.
Oh, my God. I love Vic.
Roses.
I wanted to, like, cozy up in the sack with Vic Dana and just lay there forever.
Mr. Flores,
but he couldn't sing for crap.
No, not so good.
No, kind of like John Davidson on Slow Cook. Here's one that says from Barbara in Sunrise, Hi, Neil, in honor of Good Friday, could you please play All You Can Eat Negro? It'll kill a lot of time. Thanks, Neil. You are the best. Enjoy your week off. Thanks, Barbara. I'll give it some consideration. I'll think about it. Rosemary, on the other hand, sends me something nauseating. She says, please add Reese's peanut butter eggs to your list. Oh, that sounds so bad.
Yeah.
First of all, I don't like peanut butter candy. I'm not that crazy, but I mean, peanut butter's okay, although I haven't had any in years, long time.
Really?
You eat peanut butter?
Yeah, I like peanut butter.
Really? Peanut butter and jelly?
Oh, yeah.
Get out.
I do.
Get out of town. So what was that about Jesse Agnew replacing Joe Sakaki?
I don't know anything about that.
Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, do you want to put that on there? You can go ahead. I don't really care, but it just sounds horrible to me.
Well, I guess some people like it, so we'll add it.
Well, some people like it, or they wouldn't make it, because then if nobody liked it, nobody'd buy it.
That's true.
Neil@neilrogers.com. That's our email address, and believe me, no waiting today. Oh, here's a couple. Who's this from? Oh, Steve from Vegas. I was down in Orlando last week visiting my dad. He moved up there about 20 years ago. He was a big fan of the old WIOD. He asked me whatever happened to his favorite, Sandy. He used to love the crossover with Sandy and Uncle Mikey. Sandy Payton. Oh, my God. When I told him the story about how Anbo stiffed her longtime girlfriend and left the money to Sandy, my dad said nothing could have been going on there because Sandy was a nice girl from the beach, and she wasn't that way. Maybe my dad was really... Jack, they used to say, hello, nice lady. Oh, yeah, there was a caller named Jack. He used to always call Sandy Payton, hello, lovely lady. It was lovely lady, not nice lady. Get it right, Steve.
I would love to keep you all to myself. Have a nice day.
Oh, my God. She was just one of the all-time worst. Sandy Payton. And they thought she was like a real broadcast, a real talk show person.
Really?
Her and Bill Smith. So coma-inducing that the whole world would be like... sleeping forever, for eternity. Hello, lovely lady. I don't know how some people do those voices because you get all choked up. Jim and Kendall says happy Friday. Andy is alive and well and still doing shows at his theater in Branson, Missouri.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, they got a casino there, and they got those, over-the-hill guys like Andy Williams do shows for us old farts.
Oh, it's so wonderful.
Derek says the reason more people want to spend time with their fathers than their mothers is probably because their mom is still alive. At least that was my reason. For today's poll, Reese's peanut butter eggs were always the best eat your candy. Oh, oh my God. I never even heard of such a thing, but it just sounds horrendous. Oh, Dana says I don't have a vagina. Should I go by another name? No, Dana's okay. Although Bill Dana, see, I was thinking it was somebody with a first name Dana. Do you know any guys named Dana?
I went to high school with a guy named Dana.
Dana Carvey?
There's one.
Dana, I don't know. You went to high school with a guy named Dana?
Yep.
Now, was there some confusion there? Because Dana is usually a girl's name, right?
True.
What are some other names that are, like, ambiguous?
Kelly.
Kelly's good? Kelly's very good.
Chris.
Chris?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
What
Bill?
Else? Harry.
Harry, yeah. Harry's good. So anyway, speaking of Harry situations, at a Thursday Mass in Dublin's pro-cathedral, an Irish archbishop shocked his congregation, which included numerous priests, by exclaiming that a forthcoming investigative report will reveal that over three decades, Irish Catholic priests have abused thousands of children.
All of these things.
Oh, my God.
The report will make us and the entire church a humbler church, he said. What a bunch of gobbledygook. It'll make us humbler. Make us more embarrassed, and make us more bankrupt. The Archbishop said the report compiled by the Dublin Archdiocese Commission of Investigation is expected to show that thousands of children or young people across Ireland were abused by priests in the period under investigation, and the horror of that abuse was not recognized for what it is. Hey, what it is. The government-appointed commission was set up to investigate abuses within the Dublin Archdiocese in 2006, the same year the diocese admitted that up to 102 of its priests were suspected of abusing children. The report is studying how complaints of child sexual abuse were handled. Martin is seen as a reformer sent in by the Vatican to clean up a church rocked by a decade and a half of scandals, reports The Guardian. One of the most notorious in the mid-1990s involved priest Brendan Smith and indirectly led to the collapse of Albert Reynolds' government. Accusations that the Irish Attorney General's office blocked moves to extradite Smith to Northern Ireland led to the Irish Labour Party pulling out of the coalition with Reynolds' Fianna Fáil, whatever that is, and the government falling. You know what the Fianna Fáil is?
Nope.
Who cares? The Archdiocese of Dublin is facing challenges of a kind that it has not experienced for many years, he said. Archbishop of Dublin, Diarmuid, warned that a massive investigation of parishes in the Irish capital will find children were subjected to horrific attacks between 1975 and 2004. According to the BBC, in 1999, the then Irish Prime Minister, Bertie Ahern, delivered an unprecedented apology to the victims on behalf of the state. He also set up the commission to report on abuse allegations in institutions such as schools, orphanages, hospitals, and children's homes that were funded by the state but were mainly run by Catholic religious orders. Some of the allegations date all the way back to the 1930s. And this report will make us a humbler church.
Yeah.
Says Pops. Yeah, humbler my ass. More and more bankrupt. They have to keep selling off all of their pornography collection, all the other things, all that paintings, all that crap, all their property, so they can pay all the lawsuits for all their pedophile priests. Oh, but these are just isolated incidents. Yeah, likely story.
Right.
How can there be, like, hundreds of thousands of isolated incidents? It's like saying that crazy people with guns killing people is just, they're just isolated.
Mm-hmm.
Like last week. Well, remember that day we had the Pittsburgh thing, and then we had just a whole bunch of them.
Yep.
65 votes on the poll. My favorite Easter candy is Cadbury Cream Eggs, 20. How about I don't eat candy?
We got, I can't eat any.
Well, that's because they could be diabetic or whatever.
Which doesn't mean they still don't have a favorite, though.
How about I don't eat candy?
I'll add that.
Cadbury Cream Eggs, 20. Chocolate Bunnies, 8. Cadbury Eggs, 7. Those are the ones I'm talking about. Hershey Kisses, 7. That's not Easter candy, but we'll leave it on there to humor Charlie B. Jelly Beans, 6. I can't eat any, 6. 5. Marshmallow Peeps, 5. Malted Chocolate Easter Eggs, 4. Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 2. Feh. Easter M&M's, 1. And none for Gummy Bunnies or Marshmallow Easter Eggs.
Listening to Neil Rogers.
It's Friday, you bastard.
Do you fear your nephew is in hell?
I feel that my nephew is not with the Lord, no.
Not with the Lord? Then, in other words, in hell?
I don't know. I fear he's not with the Lord, though. And because they ate part of his body like a limo.
You fear that Roman Catholic communion is they ate your nephew's body?
Yes, sir.
All right, we have on the line in Van Nuys here. A Roman Catholic priest on KFI AM 640. Hello.
How you doing?
Good.
Hey, listen, ma'am, first of all, I offer my condolences to you on the loss of your nephew.
Are you a priest?
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Okay, so I just wanted to let you clarify something for you, okay?
Yeah.
So this is just, you've been misinformed about the Catholic Church.
Why do you eat people?
Well, if you just hang on, I will explain to you what our belief is, and then you can draw your own conclusion.
But you eat people?
Let me explain what our teaching is, and you draw your own conclusion.
Let the father explain, okay?
Okay, first of all, we believe that when we receive communion, we receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Oh my God.
Well, hold on, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
I mean,
I'm just calling to let you know what our belief is.
You eat flesh and blood.
If you want to look at it that way, that's fine.
Oh my God,
that's fine. This is our belief, and you draw your own conclusion.
I want to vomit.
Ma'am, you got to let the father explain.
Why would I want to hear him talk about eating people?
Well, because you've been misinformed.
This is like Hellraiser, like Clive Barker.
Okay, first of all, okay, you're upset because you've been misinformed about what happened to your nephew in our ritual.
You eat the butt, you eat the whole damn thing, though.
Excuse me?
Don't you eat it?
We eat the host, yes.
The host?
But he said he eats the whole body of the man.
That's not what I said.
You said you eat the blood and the flesh.
Of who?
Of a man.
No, of Jesus Christ.
Oh, God. Oh, that is a blasphemy.
Well, if you choose to believe that, all I'm trying to do is inform you about our belief because you've been misinformed.
Do you eat up on the booty, too?
I'm not even going to answer that.
I don't understand. What's that mean?
What is this man talking about eating the Lord Jesus?
Let him finish.
Okay.
Let him just say what he has to say.
From the scriptures, ma'am, where Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and said, take this and eat it. This is my body.
Oh, God.
And then he took the cup of wine and he said, take and drink. This is my blood. And again he says, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you have no life within you.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. This is Good Friday.
Exactly.
And you're talking about eating up on Jesus.
I'm just calling to inform you of what we believe.
You're grubbing on Jesus, ain't you?
If
what?
You choose to believe it.
You're grubbing all over on Jesus.
If that's what you choose to believe.
And my nephew, what about him?
Okay, ma'am, as again.
Macking on Jesus. Them Catholics macked on my boy.
Macked on your boy.
I don't believe that. I'm sorry.
Them Catholics macked on your boy, huh?
You want to laugh at me?
Can I ask you a question?
You son of a bitch, you laugh at me?
Excuse me, yeah. Ma'am, let me ask you a question here.
It's like some kind of Negro smorgasbord over there.
Well, I'll tell you. Listen.
Okay, now, as far as that other man is concerned.
It's like a brother buffer.
Oh, my gosh. I'm in a phone
book. Listen, Father, I thank you for taking the time.
Okay.
I really do.
All right, ma'am, you have a good Easter.
Well, you pay for your sins.
Well, I'll leave that up to God.
That's true. Thanks,
bye-bye.
Father. All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. That was a Roman Catholic priest.
They're macking on my boy like a brother buffet. Oh, you can eat me. Oh.
What was it? What's it called, man?
All you can eat, Negro.
So there you go. Perfect for Easter.
It's still funny.
Yeah, it's good. That's back in the days when Phil was funny, when he was doing the voices before he decided to become a Nazi.
Yeah.
You know, to each its own.
And a bad actor.
The fake Doug Lindsay says, Vic Dana, born August 26, 1942, in Buffalo, New York. How do you like that? He's a couple months older than I am.
Hmm.
Old fart. Is an American dancer and singer. He's a dancer? Oh, he ought to be on Dancing with the Stars. Discovered by Sammy Davis Jr., he's best known for his 1965 recording of Red Roses for Blue Lady that was a top 10 Billboard single hit. His album of the same title made it to the top 20. Red Roses. See, what a memory I got, huh?
Yeah, pretty good.
And you found it in there in George's pile of crap.
Yep.
Other hit recording. Oh, and somebody also said Dana Andrews. Remember the actor Dana Andrews?
Oh, yeah.
He was like in a lot of war movies. Am I right?
Yeah.
Other hit recordings on the Billboard Hot 100 chart in the 60s, Little Altar Boy, I Will, More, Shangri-La, I Love You Drops, and If I Never Knew Your Name. I Love You Drops was written and recorded by country singer Bill Anderson and was popular enough to be recorded by others, including Don Cherry and Teresa Brewer. Not the hockey Don Cherry.
No.
Well, speaking of hockey, how about those Panthers? Another year, no playoffs. Wow.
10 years.
10 years, no playoffs. Bye-bye, Jack Martin. Loser. And they're going to lose Bo Mister and get nothing for him.
Yep.
And the future of that franchise is in its past, is in its behind. And all the points they've frittered away in the last 3 or 4 weeks, I mean, it's shameful. And the fact that this goofball coach kept playing Vokoun a month and 2 ago in games that they could have won.
They had Craig one Anderson. Game where they didn't have one shot on goal in the third period. How is that possible?
Jersey game, I think.
God.
Anyway, he also scored a chart hit in 1970 with Neil Diamond's Red, Red Wine, years before it was turned into a number one hit by UB40. His last nationally charted record was Larry Weiss's Lay Me Down, Roll Me Out to Sea on the Casino label, which hit the top 20 on Billboard's Easy Listening Survey of Vic Dana. He's still alive. Still alive. How do you like that? You never heard of Vic Dana, though. Now, did you recognize that song when you played it?
Yes, I did, for sure.
Oh, you know who else sang that? Wayne Newton.
Really?
On Capitol Records, Wayne Newton. I want some. Now, there's a guy. Talk about no talent and making a lot of money.
Yeah.
Of course, he had to have a lot of money to pay off the mob or all those stories, you know.
What about Tom Jones?
What about Tom Jones?
I don't know. I don't think he's that talented
either. In his earlier days, I thought he was horrible. But then when he came back as a goofy old man, I thought he was funny. Not talented, but funny.
Yeah.
In fact, don't we have that bit F-bomb? That's a Tom Jones thing. F-bomb, F-bomb. Yeah. I forget the real song that Tom Jones did that this is a parody on. Do you recognize that song that Tom Jones hit?
No.
Somebody will know what it was, what the real hit was. Brandon says, love Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, so whenever the holidays roll around and I get the... that in different shapes and sizes, I go nuts. Oh, you people with your peanut butter. It's like me with mushrooms. I love mushrooms, but not on pizza. I hate mushrooms on pizza.
I love mushrooms, too.
I love mushrooms, man. Mushrooms and onions. Oh, cook me up a big batch of that, and I'll go nuts.
I made some last night.
You did shrooms?
Mushrooms, onions, put some red peppers and this spicy sausage.
Oh, so you do the cooking at home?
Oh, yeah. I love to cook.
I'll be damned. Sounds really
gay,
but nevertheless. Brandon says, for Easter, there's nothing like a big, solid milk chocolate bunny. You know those big ones?
Mm-hmm.
You eat the whole thing? You eat the wabbit? Now, it might take me a day or two to eat the entire thing, but I will do it. And I love some Easter Bunny sweet tarts also, he says.
Really?
I don't know what that is.
No, me neither.
And just on a side note, you always talk about candy during times like Halloween and Easter, and especially during Halloween, you ask, who the hell eats candy corn? Not only do I eat candy corn, I love it.
Oh.
Horrible.
Nasty.
The worst swill on the face of the earth. And he says, I don't wait till Halloween to get it. I usually will get a bag a couple of times a year to snack on it. I'm most likely the only person in the world who actually likes and buys candy corn outside of Halloween. Candy corn is mushy, and I always tell you, I hate mushy food.
I was surprised that you'd never heard of a Chico stick.
A what?
Chico stick?
No, I saw it on there the other day, but...
Man, those are good. Well, they used to
never heard of it.
I don't think they make them anymore.
Thank God.
No, they were good.
Just another excuse. It's all this food stuff, you know, just like the Jews with Passover and with... Even Yom Kippur is food-oriented. No food.
No way.
Most of the Jewish holidays have to do with certain kinds of food, or, like I said, Yom Kippur, no food. Right?
That's crazy.
What do you mean it's crazy? At least it gives you a reason to look forward to it. Like Homintoshen on Purim. Can there be anything in the world better than a good, soft Homintoshen? Not those little horrible triangles. I've been telling you that for 100 years. Those are for Goyim. The Orthodox try to push that off as the really authentic Homintoshen. Fe.
Yeah, what do they know?
Charlie B. says he's got Easter candy facts to go with the Easter candy poll. Isn't this nice?
Yeah.
Isn't this sweet? I'm not eating, no Easter candy, I don't think.
No.
Well, that's a lie. I'll get some over the weekend. Unless I disappear. So what do you think of my idea of just taking off? I could wind up in Amsterdam or somewhere. Or...
Not a bad place to end up.
I don't know. Maybe Vancouver?
Try Barcelona. It's a great city.
I've never been to Barcelona.
Oh, it's awesome.
I sent Paco to Barcelona last year. He loved it.
One of my favorite cities.
Of course, they speak his language, but...
True.
Nevertheless. Easter is the second most important candy-eating occasion of the year for Americans, who consumed 7 billion pounds of candy in 2001, according to the National Confectioners Association. In 2000, Americans spent nearly $1.9 billion on Easter candy, while Halloween sales were nearly $2 billion. Christmas, an estimated $1.4 billion, and Valentine's Day, just over $1 billion. Small potatoes.
Mm-hmm.
90 million chocolate Easter bunnies are produced each year. Chocolate bunny should be eaten ears first, according to 76% of Americans. 5% said bunny should be eaten feet first, while 4% favored eating the tail first. I wonder how many favored eating the
rectum
first. Yeah, rabbit ass.
Yeah, and it's already brown.
There you go again.
Sorry.
Jolly Joe Bell planted that seed in your mind. The image of him down on his hands and knees. And did he also wipe off the walls in there in the tea room?
He did.
Sounds like a fat boy. I bet you Jeff High is back in the building again. Because once before, there was a splatter that really did matter. I mean, people were just puking their guts, racing out of that room. Adults prefer milk chocolate 65% to dark chocolate 27%. Mm-hmm. I prefer dark chocolate big time. Although, I will tell you, I've changed my tune about candy. We'll get back to this.
Okay.
It'll kill some really good time. I'm convinced that the best candy bar of all is a Hershey bar with almonds.
Ooh, that's good.
Yeah, very simple, very plain, nothing fancy schmancy, nothing inside of it, but just a good old-fashioned Hershey bar with almonds. Man, give me 20 or 30 of those.
Oh, Neil!
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is your brain. Any questions?
The story that rocked Palm Beach and the world.
Uncle Ted, dude, throw on some boxer shorts, let's cruise our bar and rage with some babes. Excellent.
Power, money, women, and poontang.
Uncle Ted, dude, let's use our infamous last names to impress these babes and do the wild thing at the compound.
No way, Bill.
Yes way, Ted.
They're powerful. They like to swim naked. William Kennedy Smith and Ted Kennedy in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, Part 2, The Next Genitalia.
Excellent!
Coming soon to a theater near you. Rated X for excellent.
701 at 560 WQM. Thank you, Paul Castronova, by the way. That was one of his two bits. Did you know that?
No, I did not.
That's Castronova.
Wow.
He also did the Rick Sanchez, One in a Million. I think that was him. No, I'll tell you which Rick Sanchez one it was. One moment, please. It was the board game, Rick Sanchez board game.
Coming this Christmas from...
That's him. That's Paulie. Sorry, Paulie.
Now what? I can hear it, yeah.
You hear the voice?
Yep.
Oh, don't drop it. I don't want to drop my crap on the floor here.
Then no,
Joe would have
don't.
To come and clean it up. Dana White, president of the Ultimate Fighting Championship, says Brandon.
Yep.
Well, I don't know who that is. Do you know Dana White?
I do.
You know Perry White?
No.
Perry White from Superman.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Don't tell me you don't know Perry White. Now, this one, speaking of Joe Bell, this email is definitely from him.
Okay.
It says from Michael Phelps. Crunch bars are the best candy bars, Mom. Well, first of all, we're not going to that thing again about the best candy bars. This is for Easter candy. We've done that one a million times. I still like those Mary Janes. God, I love those.
Yeah, those are good.
With honey.
Mm-hmm.
And then it says here, Flea for new sidekick 09. That's Joe Bell. Like Flea a lot. He's good. He's been a great week. We've had a good time. But the answer to that is absolutely not.
Yeah, it's been fun.
All you people that want to stab George in the back. There's nothing worse than a backstabber. You got that by the OJs? That's a good song, The Backstabbers.
Let me see.
Although I do like Lipstick Traces better by the OJs. That's a great song. But The Backstabbers is not bad. Adam Oshmuck over there in Kitchener-Waterloo, Ontario, says they make Snickers eggs at Easter. Why did I do this poll today? I could have gotten out of here alive and gone on vacation for 9 or 10 days and not croaked from diabetic coma. The OJs. God. A long pause. Speaking of OJ, I hope he's getting his on the inside. I really mean the inside.
Rectum.
Yeah. Hope he's having a real good time in the slime ball. Oh, how can you say that about the juice? The juice. Anybody that ever wore a jockstrap, man, they can do whatever the hell they want. Kill people. Whatever. Pop, pop, pop.
What they do, they smile in your face. All the time they
okay. Don't you love that song?
It's a good song, yeah.
The OJs were great. Very underrated group, the OJs.
I like the Spinners a lot.
Spinners are, fabulous. What's my favorite Spinner song? I bet you got a bunch of them there.
Let's check it out.
Games people play, of course, but that's not my favorite. It says also, this is from Adam, have you had the Rocky Road Snickers yet? Never heard of it. Has dark chocolate and marshmallows, you'd love it. I recently saw Hershey mixed nut bar. It's got almonds, peanuts, macadamias, and pecans. Sounds like a wiener to me, says Adam. Well, I'll take your word for it. No candy. So let me ask you this. What would be a good place to, like, take off and just disappear? Amsterdam would be good because it's a bohemian place. You know, they're like...
I love Amsterdam.
I did live there for 2 summers, you know.
Did you?
Because before I had the current summer deal, I had the whole summer off. Are you aware of that?
I was not aware
of that. In the early days of QAM, my early contract, the first or second one, had the whole summer off, like August, September, whatever.
Yeah, because now you're just Tuesdays and Thursdays, right?
Yeah, now I just work Tuesdays. And that's not that far off either. That starts like in the middle of June. So I'd have to be a fool. If I'm going to do something like that, I would have to probably do it like in September, right around Labor Day time,
mm-hmm.
when I'm supposed to go back to the full schedule. Follow what I'm saying?
I hear you.
I mean, you got to be a fool to take off and disappear and not get paid, you know, like walk away. Although I got a couple of bucks salted away. You know, I could just take it all out and use it on myself for once.
There's a thought.
Yeah. Instead of supporting the rest of the world. The fake Johnny Dark says, Phil Henry is a great talent. Great talent.
Are you sure?
I hate when you say he used to be great just because of his political beliefs differ from yours. Well, guess what? Take a look at his career right now, okay?
Okay.
Languishing at best. You have no credibility. You say Howard Stern was great 15 years ago, but I remember when he came in the market on Big 106 in the mid-90s, you said he was washed up. I remember when the Bird would play tapes of Howard when you were on WINZ. This is when Howard was on WNBC, and they piped a show down the NBC network line. You loved him until he came into the market, and he was competition. Then he was washed up. You know, you say the same thing about Phil Henry. You are the one who's washed up, sir, says the fake Johnny Dark, or the real one, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I'm washed up. I'm still pulling down a couple of bucks, at least as long as they keep paying it. Oh, but we got like, we're in big trouble. Yeah, too bad. Everybody's in big trouble, so they say. I think most of them are just looking to screw people now. This is a great opportunity for management types to just stab people in the back and screw people. Oh, well, geez, we're millions short and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, okay, whatever. Go screw somebody else, Joe Bell. Go ahead. He's the screwer, and I'll let him find some new screwee besides people on this show. This show has taken so much butchering since this butcher came to town. But then again, I guess that's what you expect from a butcher, is butchering, right?
Right.
Lived up to his name. The Butcher of the Airwaves. Captured American tries to escape. Somali pirates stopped his swim to safety. Wow. How do you like that?
I find it funny that there's pirates.
I beg your pardon?
I find it so funny that there's still pirates out there.
Yeah, well, I saw too many Johnny Depp movies.
I like Johnny Depp.
So, I love Johnny Depp. He was on my show on Zeta. I wish I still had that picture that with us, with our arm around each other. I mean, there was no romance, you know.
Yeah, he used to live in Miramar, right?
Yeah, he grew up there. And then at one time he was down on his luck and he lived in his car for a while.
Wow.
Lived in his car. Rudy says, I bet that flea never went to Madrid.
No.
Yeah, I've been to Madrid. It's much better than Barcelona.
No
way.
Well,
if that's the case, I'll pass in Barcelona.
No,
Madrid
Barcelona is way better.
Since Barcelona is by far the most expensive city in Spain and less friendly. Furthermore, the official language in Barcelona is Catalan.
True.
And they are militant about it, just like the French Canadians are with their language, said Rudy.
A little bit, yeah.
He don't like Barcelona.
He's crazy. Barcelona is way more fun than Madrid.
Madrid is just, I don't
right.
know.
It's Madrid-y.
You know what Madrid reminded me of? Milan, Italy.
Never been.
The buildings are kind of like sterile and all look the same. I just didn't think. I mean, it was okay. Aaron says, I was at Kohl's the other day and noticed they now have Easter candy corn. There you go, Brandon.
Blah.
It's the same as Halloween candy corn, but in pastel colors it looked nasty. Oh, just the thought of it makes me start. The gag reflex is kicking in. God. Oh, look at this. Ray L. has a poll suggestion. My favorite holiday is blank. And on the list, oh, he's got a long list of holidays. He's got Purim on there.
Wow. How about President's Day?
I'd say Purim if I can get some Homintosh, but I haven't had any in so long, so many years. I'm jonesing for some good Homintosh. Now, are you a Homintosh guy?
I don't think I've ever had that.
Oh, Jews from Tampa, don't believe a word of it. Just because his name is Feldman, don't believe there's any Jew in this child. You never had Homintoshen?
No, I don't think
so. What about Kishki?
Oh, yeah.
Well, what do you mean, oh, yeah? Like, Kishki is more. I mean, granted, Kishki can have any time of the year.
Right.
If you can find it.
What's the other one? The potato...
Latkes?
Oh, those are good.
Well, what do you mean, what's the other one?
I don't know. I don't know.
Potato pancakes. Is that tough pancakes? If you don't know your latkes?
Is that what it is? It's just a pancake?
Aftulachas, man. Aftulachas. You don't even know your Yiddish.
No, not really.
Well, that's because you grew up in Tampa.
Yep, I know.
They
Redneck.
Did have that deli there for about 5 minutes. Lasseter and I, it was a sponsor of his for about 5 minutes. And then they went out of business. Too many goyim in Tampa.
Yeah.
Nothing but goyim. Although they have at least one or two shuls there, I know that.
Mm-hmm. The only time I would get really good Jewish food is when I would go visit family up in Chicago.
Oh, yeah.
Oof.
A lot of Jews in Chicago.
Oh,
a lot
yeah.
of Jews in Toronto, but no Jewish food.
Yeah, that's where my dad's from, is Chicago. I'm going up there in May.
Well, I'll be damned.
Going to Wrigley Field. Can't
that'd wait. Be a good place to hide.
Oh, yeah. That's a great
Chicago.
City.
Chicago.
Yeah.
Just hang out at Wrigley Field.
Yep. Get a Chicago dog.
Oh, yeah. I love those. With the real green relish.
Oh, yeah.
And the peppers.
Now you're talking.
You know where they have that? I wonder if they're still open there in Fort Lauderdale. I bring this up every few months. This comes up on the show, and I keep forgetting the name of it. Hot Diggity Dog or something like that. It's across from one of the car dealers.
Oh, yeah. Diggity Dog.
Is that it? Diggity Dog?
It's still there, yeah.
Wow. They got great Chicago dogs.
There's another new place called Dogma, which is real good, too.
Dogma?
Yeah.
Matt Damon eat there? Did you
Maybe.
See the movie Dogma?
I did. I like
George Carlin was in it, but he's still dead.
Yeah.
James says they make Hershey's Kisses wrapped in pastel foil for sale around Easter, much like they make pastel M&Ms.
Right.
Same deal, just a gimmick to cash in on a holiday. Oh, not come on, James. Don't be so cynical. Oh. Just a gimmick to cash in on a holiday. That's what all these holidays are for. It's all commercial. It's all business, man. And, of course, now with the economy the way it is, how's the Dow doing? Oh, the Dow won't be open today. It's Good Friday. The Goyim run the world, so there'll be no Dow today. No down news on the stock market. CNBC, it says marijuana. What does that mean? I got to do a Joyce, by the way.
Ooh.
So if I don't come back after this night. Marijuana, Inc., Inside America's Pot Industry. Trish Regan hosts an investigation of America's marijuana trade. Ooh, sounds really sinister to me. So don't forget, I'm going to Joyce and rejoice, and hopefully everything will be just fine.
O'Neill!
Fatwa Friday, you bastards.
Tacos, what are we gonna do? I say, tacos, we are all being screwed. I say, listen, why is this happening to us? We want the FCC to get off our butts. Tacos, there's no place for us now. Even DJs are all down in the mouth. You can listen, but now you won't find any word that will corrupt your mind. No fun to be censored by the FCC. No fun to be censored by the FCC. There'll be nothing left for us to enjoy. We'll soon be playing with children. By the FCC. They want us to be clean. They think they know what we should feel. They try to dictate to us what is real. Young and old, please listen to us. I say, young and old, please don't put up a fuss. Help us petition the FCC. But you must help us with one thing. Neil Rogers can't do it all by himself. Let's all help him. Don't put it up on the shelf. Let the FCC know just how you feel. And maybe we'll get this unjust law repealed. FCC, what are you doing to us? FCC, what are you doing to us? Our ratings won't fly. In fact, they might die because of the FCC. You want to ban what we can. FCC, you ban what we can say. You've even tried to ban the records that the DJs play. People, I am talking to you. I said, people, let's stand and fight for what's true. Send your letter into so far so we can tell the FCC what Neanderthals they are. Neil Rogers and so far are on your side. We have nothing to hide, young and old. Get your opinions out, and maybe the FCC will stay out. FCC in the morning now.
FCC
in the evening now. No one knows what words drive them insane. We all have the FCC to blame. FCC.
Away. 11:19 at 560 WQM. You notice I'm just digging in there and pulling out some old crap today.
Mm-hmm. It's good.
That we haven't heard in a while. Of course, that one's always something. My favorite Easter candy is, that's our poll question, 150 votes here on Good Friday. What about Pesadiki candy for the Jews? What do you think?
Okay.
My favorite Easter candy is Cadbury Cream Eggs, 32. Chocolate Bunnies, 17. Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 16. Feh. Jelly beans, 16. Jelly beans is Easter candy?
I think, yeah, because they do the pastel colors.
Well, what is that with the pastel colors? What does that mean?
It's just another way to sell candy.
Oh. Marshmallow peeps, 14. I don't eat candy, 13. I don't believe that.
Right.
Do you know anybody who doesn't eat candy?
Nope.
Liars. Malted chocolate Easter eggs, 12. Oh, I do like those. Mmm. I love malted anything.
Yeah.
Cadbury eggs, 9. Hershey Kisses, 8. I can't eat candy, 5. You know, diabetes people like me. Easter M&M's, 4. Marshmallow Easter eggs, 4. And gummy bunnies, none. None? Nobody don't like gummy bunnies.
Yeah.
Paul Smith. at joebell@inbox.com. Oh. Subject, Passover. Dear Neil, I'm turned off by your degrading of Mr. Joe Bell. He is a great journalist and wonderful human being. He's a journalist?
Journalist.
Wow. My girlfriend can't believe you burped on the radio and on Passover, no less. You old Jew queer fag. May God bless you and flee. He is queer, too. You ass.
What?
Clown. Doesn't say clown. But...
Oh. And now I'm gay?
Yeah, now you're gay, because you're on the show.
Gay. Okay.
Guilt by association. Oh, not on Pesach and Good Friday. Oh, what no. would the Lord think? Lord would think somebody's got heartburn. Somebody ate too many gummy bunnies. Oh, look at that. The red lights are on both things there. It doesn't mean anything. I understand that. But we're streaming, and the Outlook Express is working. Yeah, yesterday was just too much.
That was a nightmare.
An absolute nightmare. Oh, Phil Ark is back. Hello. I've noticed that since Lee Feldman's been at the controls this week, there hasn't been enough sound effects like when George is at the controls. Tell me he needs to shape up. No. Get on the ball if he has ambitions of taking George's job.
Well, A, I don't, and B, George can do these things with his eyes closed because he's so used
to
hitting the sound
effects. He has to be quicker to press the sound effect drops when you refer to a relevant topic.
Okay.
He's a fellow handicrapper, and after winning last week, here are my picks. I don't really care what. I'm not even going to look at it.
Yeah.
Not interested. This guy who's trying to inject himself into the show. All these people with no lives. Oh, I'm going to a fellow handicapper. Go to hell. How much are you getting paid to do it? Now, here's one from Timothy. It says, there are many Jews in Toronto and Jewish-style foods all over the place. When I visited relatives there a few years back, they took me to a couple of bakeries. In fact, so I'm sure that Homintoshen aren't that tough to find. The hot dog place you're thinking of in Fort Lauderdale is Hot Dog Heaven on Sunrise Boulevard. Still there. Chicago-style place. Arbiters is still open in Dade, by the way. Char Hut is still around, too, but with fewer locations. Still in Tamarack, Davie, Pembroke Pines, etc. No longer on commercial, unfortunately. They just opened a place in Palm Beach Lakes. And if Flea thinks Dogma is worth going to, he's got taste in his tush.
Whatever.
Overpriced yuppie hot dogs, not for this kid. Says Tim, have a nice weekend and pass the Gribbenus. Have you had Gribbenus?
No.
Oh, make-believe Jew, ersatz. Oh, Dana changed his name to Darius. Yeah. It's like me and Steve Ziegler. I got him to take off that hairpiece, heave it. Adam Kirshner says, can you play the Weather Girls and dedicate it to Alice Rantel and Norma Kant? Thanks. It's raining men. No, we can't and we won't. And another link. Keep sending the links and I'll keep deleting them, okay? Just keep bringing them on. Bring them along. What is with these people? What part of that don't they understand?
I don't know.
From your friend Adam Kirshner. Did he send you anything today?
Yeah, he sent me a link.
Did he really?
Yeah.
What was it? The Phil Henry bit?
I don't know. I couldn't tell because it's on my phone.
Oh, just delete it.
Okay, done.
Delete it. Could be the greatest thing in the history of mankind. We're going to delete it. We don't do links. Dana Hall is now Danus, D-A-N-U-S. Oh, he put the anus in Danus. He says, I've noticed that all the people I've spoken to voted for Obama, not happy with him already. It takes time to get this ship from the sea floor. Bush is a deadhead. Bill Maher sucks. Oh, I see.
I'm going to go see Bill Maher on tomorrow night.
On what?
He's performing at Nova.
And you're going to go see him?
I'm going to check it out. I got free tickets.
Oh,
so.
My God. Now, did you watch Religious?
Yes, I did. It was okay.
I thought it was pretty good.
Yeah, it was okay.
By the way, 11 Horse Field at Gulfstream, there's no rain, so the 12 is going to be scratched. Entered for the main track only, meaning if they took it off the grass, off the weeds. How do you like that friggin' Phil Ark? He's handicapped. I don't care about his selections. I did look at Ron Nicoletti's selections. He didn't pick, he picked my horse third. I got the one. He picked the 5-3-1-6.
Well, if he picked it third, then you're guaranteed to win.
There's no guarantees, mister, in the horse racing business.
That's true.
As we saw last week when the gate opened and the 7 came out sideways. Took a right turn out of the gate.
Maybe the fix was on.
What is it?
Maybe the fix was on.
Now, what did you say about Joe Zagacki?
Nothing.
I'm sure I heard you say...
Joe Zagacki sucks, okay?
I could be just dreaming. I could be just hallucinating.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Don't be talking about the fixes on. Are you suggesting that there are races that are like not on the up and up that aren't kosher?
I don't know.
What you know about horse racing is the same as you know about Jewish food, food.
That's true.
Nothing.
I used to be a lead out, though, at the Derby Lane in St. Pete with the dogs.
You did what?
I was a lead out. You know, the guys that bring the dogs out
and
show.
Oh, are you kidding me?
That was an awesome job.
Those little pansy kids that bring out the dogs on a leash?
That was me when I was in high school.
And they play that syrupy music, you know, during the little post-parade.
Yep.
Oh. I used to go to the dogs and I used to enjoy it. Biscayne, when Ken Malden worked at Biscayne. How's Ken doing? Anybody hear from him?
Yeah, I heard from him the other day.
You did?
Yeah, he's doing okay, I guess. You know, he's bored.
Talk about a royal screwing. There's another example of your buddy Joe Bell. You know, judge a man by the friends he keeps. And you and Jolly Joe Bell, what a classic perfecta.
O'Neill!
It's Friday, you bastards.
Ask if I am sure. One more time, and I'll blow my brains out. Why ask if I'm sure about everything I do? Whenever I download a file or hit delete, I want to die from stupid questions it keeps asking me. Are you sure you want to shut down? Are you sure you want to empty trash now? Yes, I'm sure, and I'll click yes and kiss my ass.
Rectum.
I don't know why my computer should ask at all when I decide about software I have to install. Microsoft crap, my head's not that far up my ass. Yes, I'm certain. Obey my command, my mind's made up. But I would not fit it at all.
Oh, I gotta rejoice.
Are you really sure?
I mean, emergency like.
Yes or no? It's constantly asking. Yes, I'm really sure.
Are you sure? Are you sure? Are you sure?
Yes, sir.
11:32 at 560 WQAM. Yeah, I'm going to rejoice, so we'll take the next break a little bit early. Let me just give you a little heads up on that now.
Okay.
Not like, you know, life and death urgent, but fairly urgent. Maybe it's all this candy talk. You think that could be it?
Could be.
Or not. The search is on for a team of crooks who robbed an Arlington couple at gunpoint for their takeout Popeye's chicken in Jacksonville. According to police, a young mother was leaving her shift and closing the Popeye's restaurant in Arlington on Atlantic Boulevard when she noticed she was being followed home, and they robbed them for their takeout Popeye's chicken. All right.
Popeye's is good.
Well, it is. Is it?
Yeah.
Ain't never had no Popeye's.
Oh, man, that's good.
That's a good poll question. What would you rob for? Mickey D's, Burger King, Popeye's, Church's Chicken, etc.
All of these things.
Right. All of a sudden that subsided, thank the Lord. I thought I was going to do a deuce right here in the chair.
Oh, man.
I have to call Jolly Joe to come here and clean up the mess. I don't want him anywhere near here. Boy, he just... Here's one from somebody. It says, greetings, Neil and Flea. Steve. I heard you guys talking about a story regarding Arlie Ermey yesterday. Remember Arlie Ermey?
Yeah.
I don't.
No.
Neil, I've always respected and been like-minded in some of your favorite movies, i.e. Godfather, Network, Glengarry, Glenn Ross, Justice for All, etc. The performance by Arlie as the drill sergeant in Full Metal Jacket is one of the greatest performances in a film I've ever seen.
Yeah, he's awesome.
I don't think I ever saw that movie.
That's a good movie.
I'm curious how you feel about the first part of the film with him. I never saw it.
Matthew Bodine is in it, too.
Who?
Matthew Bodine.
No. Also, Phil Henry is an Obama supporter. I found his show again recently on at random times. He is definitely not right-wing anymore. I don't know what happened, but I'm glad. He sounded funny again with the Doug Danger bit to boot. It's good to have a trifecta of talent to listen to again. You, of course, Phil and La Bastard. After that, it's iPod time. Love you, Neil. Cheers, Steve. Me, Phil, and La Bastard. Oh, I feel unclean all of a sudden. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Unclean. I will be unclean in a couple of minutes here during the break.
Well, you should wipe.
I will. Very, believe me, I'm good at that. George will tell you, I'm in the Guinness Book of Records for the fastest BMs in history. Being in this business.
Yeah, Full Metal Jacket was actually directed by Stanley
Kubrick.
Kubrick, yeah. It's a good movie. You should check it out.
Walt says, I believe the Chicago-style hot dog restaurant you're referring to is Hot Dog Heaven, right across the street from Lincoln Mercury Dealer on West Sunrise Boulevard. That is absolutely correct. He says, my dog is mustard, tomato, pickle, celery, salt only. Hmm. Still open. Hot Dog Heaven. They got a great Chicago dog there, man. Great. Yeah. At least they always did. I haven't been there in about 100 years. Well, you're out of touch. Well, if I was there, I still wouldn't be going there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's not the kind of thing, unless you happen to be, like, driving by and it's lunchtime or you're hungry, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's not the kind of thing you think, oh, gee, I'm going to drive over there to that place, to Hot Dog Heaven, and get a wiener, you know?
Right.
Do you?
No, if you're at a ball game, you know, usually you'll have one.
At a ball game, yeah.
Yeah.
Take me out to the Marlins. Now, Flea was telling me before the show this morning they're having a tough time selling out the Mets games this weekend.
Yeah.
That's really sad.
Maybe it's
not
due to the holiday.
Not as sad as the fact the Panthers missed the playoffs again.
Yeah.
Even though they won last night in Atlanta, but they, no good. Rangers won. Montreal got a point in a tie. Overtime loss. And the Panthers, no playoffs again. Year after year, season after season. I don't understand how the franchise just justifies continuing. I mean, Alan Cohen must be just hemorrhaging blood. You think?
I think so.
Got to be losing their ass. And they give away so damn many tickets. Let me just make sure the racing channel's on here. I don't want to get, like, too far away from a Gulfstream.
Right.
And next week is our last Pick the Pony thing?
Yep.
I think that it's maybe a little closer than you think, but I'm picking the same horse you are for the same reasons. Theodora, I think, wins the Santa Lucia.
Pull up, Bob Seger. Turn the page from Saturday to Sunday here at the Great Race Place. The Lanes End feature race of the week is the $100,000 Las Cienegas Handicap, a Grade 3 Field of Nine. Beller Sizzle's running for the...
Well, there it is. It's on. Okay. We're good to go. And I'm sure that the 12 is going to be scratched because, like it said, main track only. So there's no rain, so that means they'll be running on the grass. No number 12. So we've got 11-horse field. I'm picking the one. Nicole Song with the great Javier Castellano, who could use a little help with those zits, by the way. I haven't seen him lately, but he had a little bit of a zit problem.
Oh.
Maria Bartiromo says, hello, Mr. Rogers. Happy Good Friday. I'm taking an off day today as the markets are closed today for Good Friday. Would like to give you an investment tip today. The next day you notice the market is down, pull the trigger and diversify. Yeah, pull the trigger, Maria. Just come on in. It's not too late to take advantage of the Obama bounce. The markets yesterday displayed great strength, and over the summer months we'll see massive moves. I'm about to take a massive move, as a matter of fact, Maria. Have a great vacation. If you have time, drop me a line. We can have lunch next week in New York. Best regards, Maria B. P.S. Trish Regan is a bitch and trying to take my job. Oh, that's a good line. I like that. Trish Regan, who's doing that thing on marijuana right now, because they're not doing no stock market stuff because the market's closed for Good Friday because the goyim rule the world.
And Bruce Perlowin was smuggling hundreds of tons of marijuana right under the noses of federal authorities.
All right.
Well, good for him. Good for him. He's doing a service for a lot of people out there that just want a good smoke. That's all.
Supply and demand.
So how's George doing? You and George will be working together next week now.
Yep. I'll probably see him over the weekend.
You'll see him over the weekend?
Yeah.
Where?
We used to hang out every once in a while.
Get out of here. You hang out with George?
Yeah, we went to Ultra together.
I don't know. Somehow it just doesn't compute in my mind. I don't know. Not that I hang out with George.
Mm-hmm.
I think in all the years George has worked, like 17, 18 years with me on the show, I think in all those years I've had maybe, I don't know, 3-4 meals with George.
Well, I draw the line at, like, roller skating. I don't do the roller skating thing.
No. How about the sign language?
No.
Do you go to sign language classes with George?
Nope.
And roller skating? Well, now, can you explain to me, since you're so tight with George, what that's all about, the roller skating thing, besides cruising for chicks? But, I mean, there's plenty of places to cruise for chicks, but roller skating?
Well, I think he uses it as exercise as well. And he enjoys it, I guess. It's not my scene.
That's a good question. Do Jews roller skate?
Oh, it's Friday, you bastard.
I'm Chris.
Chris Matthews play hardball on MSNBC. I feel as giddy as a college schoolgirl who's wearing a skirt and those shrimpy thigh highs, and the wind just blew over my coochie. Even though the economy is dismal and our world seems to be crumbling, I feel exuberant and excited, like a 13-year-old girl going to see Twilight. Welcome to three CEOs of the automobile industry to hardball. Got Alan Mulally of Ford, Robert Nardelli of Chrysler, and Richard Wagoner of GM. Welcome to the program, gentlemen. Let's start with you, Richard. Didn't know if you realized that you're actually named after a station wagon.
That's
last name's Wagoner.
Yeah, it's
like
not
a station wagon. That's funny.
No. No.
I think it's funny. Maybe you don't have a sense of humor. Anyway, let's go to you, Alan. Don't you think it's funny that Richard Wagoner's last name is actually from a station wagon?
I think...
I know comedy. Anyway, what are you doing? An elephant with three balls? You walk him and pinch it a giraffe. Anyway, let's go to you, Robert Nardelli of Chrysler. Probably think I'm going to ask you about the Richard Wagoner name reference. I'm not going to throw you a curveball on hardball.
Okay.
Why is it that you guys flew on private jets in to get your big bailout money? Don't you think that says to the American people, screw you? I think it sort of says, screw you to the American people.
Well,
now, don't get me wrong, I'm a big believer in spend, but that's kind of crazy, right?
Well, I'm trying to say.
Although I wish I had a private plane, that way people wouldn't overhear the stupid things I say while traveling on mass transit. Let's go back to you over there, Richard Wagoner. Your name reminds me of where I had sex for the first time. Get it, station wagon. Hey, are you wearing any wood paneling on your side?
No.
Anyway, let's talk about the big bailout you guys think you deserve.
Well, thank you very much.
Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm trying to get an answer out of you. How do you feel about the bailout?
Yeah, Chris.
Go ahead.
What I'm trying to say.
Let's ask Robert Nardelli the same question. Nardelli, wait a minute. It just hit me. Your name sounds like a macaroni. I think I had some vodka sauce in Nardelli last night.
Well, I don't think so.
Funny. Come on, admit it.
No, I don't.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Banana.
Banana who?
Knock, knock. Banana. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Banana.
Who's there?
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Orange. Orange. I'm glad I didn't say banana. I know comedy. Let's go back over to Al Mulally of Ford. Wait a minute. You know what your name reminds me of? Big Valley with Miss Barbara Stanwyck. It rhymes. Mulally. Big Valley. Of course, you could also be the chick from Will and Grace with a high, squeaky voice.
Don't you think
it's funny?
Go ahead.
I'm telling you, it's funny. Miss Barbara Stanwyck, Nick Hicks, where we first saw $1 Million Man, right, Lee Major. It's funny.
Listen, we're here.
Done listening to you. Maybe no back talk to host. Tune in tomorrow when my special guest will be the priest, the rabbi, and the prostitute. That's funny. Chris Matthews played hardball on MSNBC.
My request. Wasn't that nice of me?
Yeah, I like those.
Jane Cooper City says, hello, Neil and Flea. Since it's Friday, can you play one of the Chris Matthews bits?
Go ahead.
It'll make my weekend. Have a great week. Love your show. Go ahead, Jane Cooper City. Now, you don't have to start playing a lot of drop-ins just because of that one email. Don't take it seriously.
I feel the pressure.
No, well, don't feel it. I did feel the pressure during that break, and I released it.
Yeah? How was it?
It was fine. Painless.
That's good.
Antiseptic. Just fine. Although I was, I don't want to go into it.
When it comes to joicing, painless is the way to go.
Oh, listen, I'm the expert. All these years that I've been joicing, can you imagine? In fact, I think I dropped some good Easter, some Pesadicky turds. And some Good Friday turds as well. Speaking of Easter candy. Here's the poll, 193 votes. My favorite Easter candy is Cadbury Cream Eggs, 33. Those are really, I mean, they're good, but they're sickeningly sweet. And I like sweet, but boy, they're sickeningly sweet, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 26. Oh, God almighty. Chocolate Bunnies, 25. I don't eat candy, 19. Yeah, likely story. Marshmallow Peeps, 18. Jelly Beans, 17. I still don't think jelly beans are Easter candy. I mean, jelly beans can be... Well, what does that mean, they're Easter candy?
Well, because they're usually in the Easter basket. I think that's why.
Tisket a Tasket, they're in my Easter basket?
Yep.
Malted Chocolate Easter Eggs, 14. Cadbury Egg, 10. Hershey Kisses, 10. I Can't Eat Candy, 6. Marshmallow Easter Egg, 6. Easter M&M's, 5. And Gummy Bunnies finally got 1. Somebody likes Gummy Bunnies. Well, I'll be damned. Brandon says, out and about, I was just walking and saw a bunch of young kids, no more than 10, in full Jewish garb walking around. In full Jewish garb.
I see that all the
Orthodox.
Time.
Orthodox. What?
I see that all the time.
Do you?
Yeah, in Aventura.
With the big hats and the long beards?
Yep.
Used to see that on Arthur Godfrey Road on the beach. Which is really ironic because Arthur Godfrey was a virulent anti-Semite. And I still don't understand why they named a street after him on the beach. But nevertheless, Kenilworth Hotel. No Jews allowed, no Schwarzes, no this, no that. He was one of the owners of the Kenilworth Hotel, Arthur Godfrey. Never hired a Jew on that show. Hawaii, oh my God. And they named a street after him. It goes to show you. People are masochists. They like the pain. I'm wondering if when Adolf Hitler Way is going to pop up on the beach. Although, of course, now most of the Jews have vanished from the beach, haven't they? Except a few Orthodox?
Yeah.
Isn't it mostly like Julio's now?
Yep.
Anyway, getting back to this very penetrating article about adults prefer milk chocolate 65% to dark chocolate 27%. I like it dark myself, the candy. Each Easter season, Americans buy more than 700 million marshmallow peeps shaped like chicks, as well as marshmallow bunnies and marshmallow eggs, making them the most popular non-chocolate Easter candy.
That's right.
Marshmallow peeps. That's also very, very sweet.
Oh, yeah. Sugar on sugar.
Oh, too sweet. As many as 4.2 million marshmallow peeps, bunnies, and other shapes can be made each day. In 1953, it took 27 hours to create a marshmallow peep. Today, it takes 6 minutes. It took 27 hours?
What?
Wow. How's the peeping, Tommy? How's the peeping? He's great, Philip Seymour Hoffman. Did you see the movie, what's it called?
Which one?
About the compulsive gambler, the true story in Toronto?
No.
You never saw that movie?
I don't think so.
Philip Seymour Hoffman. What's the name of that movie, folks? God, I've seen it 8 million times. Yeah, he's a banker. He works in a bank. And he's stealing all this money, creating these phony accounts to support his gambling problem. And they welcome him. They're competing for his business in Atlantic City and Vegas. And they fly him in, you know, the whole deal. It's a good movie. Philip Seymour Hoffman. The name of the movie is Owning Mahoney.
Owning Mahoney, 2003.
But it just came to me before you said it.
Yep.
How do you like that? That was shocking. Yellow peeps are the most popular, followed by pink, lavender, blue, and white. Pink and lavender sounds really...
Yay.
That's that pastel thing you're talking about again.
Yep.
Now, what's the significance of pastels in Easter? Can you tell me that?
I have no idea.
Well, somebody will tell us. You won't go to hell if you eat something pastel. Americans consume 16... Oh, you're right. 16 billion jelly beans at Easter, many of them hidden in baskets. All the Easter jelly beans were lined end to end. If they were, they would circle the globe nearly three times. Well, let's start. There's a project for you, some busy work for the weekend. Let's start lining up all the Easter jelly beans end to end, and they would circle the globe three times. I still haven't had anybody tell me a good place to go and disappear. You think I'm joking about that? It's one of those things. You know how there are things in the back of your mind, and you aren't like really serious about you're going to do them, but they every now and then it just dawns on you this is a possibility.
See, I would choose Italy just because of the great food.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, Rome. Rome is one of my very favorite cities. Berlin, Rome, Amsterdam, Vancouver, Rochester, not.
Buffalo.
Yo, Buffalo. I can't even begin to tell you what I think of Buffalo. Jelly beans did not become an Easter tradition until the 1930s. They probably were made in America. Oh, I see. They probably were first made in America by Boston candy maker William Schraft. Remember Schraft's candies?
No.
I do. Who ran ads urging people to send jelly beans to soldiers fighting in the Civil War. In the 1930s, we had a Civil War. Do you understand what that means?
No.
Oh, well, maybe that means that during the Civil War is when they made them the first time. I see.
Yeah, during the American Civil War.
I see. Oh, you looked that up?
In Boston.
In Boston.
Yep.
70% of kids aged 6 to 11 say they prefer to eat Easter jelly beans one at a time, while 25% report eating several at once. Boys, 29%, were more apt to eat a handful than girls, 18%. How do you like that?
Hmm.
Oh, Dorothy M. is peddling me a Viagra and all popular meds on my BlackBerry. Go to hell, Dorothy. More spam. If I had $100 for every spam I've gotten just in the last year and a half, I could just walk away. If I had $1 million for every spam. Children indicate their favorite Easter jelly bean flavors are cherry, 20%, strawberry, 12%, grape, 10%, lime, 7%, and blueberry, 6%. This is pretty boring.
Uh-oh, you might not want to use jelly bean on the air because it's also a slang term for pimp. You might get in trouble from Joyce.
Screw Joyce.
No, thanks.
Maybe her pimp would be upset. Too bad. Bitch. Heartless, idiotic bitch. Wouldn't know a radio if you stuck 14 transistor sisters deep inside her.
Rectum.
But nevertheless. Candy makers are offering more and more Easter products. In the early 1980s, M&Ms became available in pastel spring colors. Spring colors. I don't get that. Reese's makes peanut butter eggs, and Smucker's produces jelly beans. Smucker's.
Hmm.
I thought Smucker's made jelly.
Yeah.
That's what Mason Adams always told us. It's got to be good if it's got a name like Smucker's. Some supermarkets have doubled the space allotted to Easter candy in the past few years as the market has increased. Best place to get Easter candy is in your drugstore, Walgreens, wherever. Shoppers Drug Mart here. Right?
Yep.
Every time there's some holiday with candy, man, the drugstore is just loaded. Candy is a relatively recent Easter tradition. Chocolate eggs, the most popular Eastern candy, were first made in Europe in the early 1800s. Hot cross buns were among the earliest Easter treats made by European monks and given to the poor during Lent. Hot cross buns. Wow. Ever had a hot cross bun?
Had a Cinnabon.
No. Mm. You know what? I can't eat those because it just put me in a coma. But I like in the airports, in the food court.
Yeah.
Or anywhere in a food court where there's a Cinnabon, just standing there and smelling it.
Oh. You gain 5 pounds just from smelling it.
No, my God. The aroma could put you in a coma. It's so good. Pretzels were originally associated with Easter. The twists of a pretzel were thought to resemble arms crossed in prayer. Oh, good golly, Miss Molly. All the bubble mices all the time. For parents worried that their children might eat too much Easter candy, some experts suggest adding non-edible items to Easter baskets. Crayons, movie passes, jump ropes, baseball cards, kids' videos, stencils, markers, paperback books, chalk, Play-Doh, stuffed animals, or balls.
Boring.
Or drugs.
There you go.
O'Neill!
This is Dick Cheney. I like to relax by having Mary Magdalene massage my balls while listening to the Neil Rogers 12 to 1 hour.
And then the Lord said, "Let there be light." And lo, there was light.
From the same people who brought you the much-beloved Talking Bible comes a new 10-volume set, brilliantly updated for the 80s.
Yes, it's the Rapping Bible.
There was dark everywhere. Then the man said, "Light." And the light was there. He said, "I've done good, there's no doubt." On the seventh day, he just chilled out. Genesis, Genesis, beginning of that, beginning of this.
Finally, the good book is bad, and his word is not there.
Check it out. There's a town called Sodom and Gomorrah. Everybody partied like no tomorrow. God looked down, said, "Not my fault. Don't look back or you turn to salt." Lot's wife took a peek, started to freak. The cow came up and licked her cheek. Take a lick, y'all, of a cheek, y'all.
Imagine all the psalms, all the parables, every sacred biblical word interpreted by the finest sucker MCs of all time.
Genesis! Exodus! Deuteronomy!
The Rapping Bible, making his word fresh again.
Say, kids, what's real bad for you but tastes real good?
Sugar!
And what gives you the excess energy to drive mom crazy?
Sugar!
So, what breakfast cereal will you tell mom to buy next time she goes shopping?
Sugar Shockers! Yay!
New super sugar-coated Sugar Shockers are little bits of raw cane drenched in honey and coated with powdered sugar, glucose, fructose, corn syrup, and other natural sweeteners.
And tastes just like sugar-coated sugar!
Right, because there's no yucky vitamins or minerals to spoil your fun.
Yeah!
And how does it make you feel?
Like I'm vibrating.
Ooh. Mommy, let's watch cartoons.
Mommy, let's go get ice cream.
Mommy, let's play Smurfs.
Mommy. And moms will love Sugar Shockers, too, because inside every box, there's a free bottle of new Flintstones chewable Valium.
Yeah!
So try new super sugar-coated Sugar Shockers from your friends at Irresponsible Foods.
Oh! Promo 2 at 560 WQAM. Happy Friday to you. Good Friday, Pesach, all of this stuff.
All of these things.
Yeah. Gregory in Greg in Lurita, Florida, says, we're buying stuff that, by the way, those last two bits were both by request. Aren't you impressed?
That's nice.
Very nice of me, I think.
I think so, too.
We're buying stuffed animals instead of candy for the grandkids this year, he says. Mom and Dad don't want their kids bouncing off the walls. Pain in the ass kids ruin everything. Could you play Sugar Shockers? Yes, I did, Greg. No extra charge. Now, Kenny Gramer sent me this yesterday. This is a poll. I can't find the result of this in the Sun Sentinel, but this is actually a poll they took in the Sun Sentinel. Okay. In what used to be supposedly a newspaper. Poll, did Jesus rise from the dead?
Yeah.
Recent polls say most Americans and half of Britons believe Jesus was resurrected. In this Easter season, April 12th for Catholics and Protestants, April 19th for Eastern Orthodox, what do you believe? And here are the four choices. Jesus physically rose from the dead.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus rose, but spiritually, not physically.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus' apostles had a vision of his resurrection, or the apostles made up the resurrection story.
Right.
They should have added, is this a wild Bubba Micey or what? And then you can vote on it.
Yeah.
In the Sun Sentinel, this is a poll in a major market newspaper. Did Jesus rise from the dead? That's like, when's the poll coming? Will the tooth fairy leave dimes under your kids' pillows?
Well, to me, the best was during the Republican primaries when they had the debates and they asked the people to raise their hands if they believed in evolution, and they all raised their hands. Come on. I mean, none of them raised their hand. None of them believed in evolution.
You want to try that one again?
Yeah. Well, you know what
None
I mean.
Of them raised their hands.
None of them raised their hands. Ridiculous.
Well, I think they're living proof that we haven't evolved.
Right.
All the idiots on that panel, especially, who's the reverend? I keep forgetting his name.
Mitt Romney?
No, not Mitt Romney. He's not a reverend. He's a Mormon, the preacher.
Oh.
Oh, come on.
I can think of it, too, and right on the tip of my tongue.
Okay, yeah. John in Lake Worth says, boy, you were right with your comments about talk radio in this town. With the demise of 9:40 a.m. to the now all sports talk, which will fail miserably, that's right, there's nothing in this town to listen to. I did listen to Ed Schultz until his removal from 9:40, Randy's show until she got Schmidt canned again, and anyone else who was a hair to the left of Hitler.
Howard!
Now all the shows are right-wing talking heads. On Olbermann's show last night, he split-screened two Republicans at two different speeches, reading verbatim the same talking points. There's even a playbook out there for them. I honestly do believe there's a conspiracy in this country to limit the amount of left-slash-level-headed radio. It worked real good in the election, didn't it? Not. For the first time in my 25 years of AM radio, I'm down to your show only, and I do mean when you are alone or on. The signal up here in Palm Beach County was better 10 years ago than it's been the past few years. Can barely hear you throughout most of Palm Beach County. As of this moment, your upcoming vacation has been rescinded. You are to remain on the air. Yeah. Have a relaxing time on your vacation. Got my iPod ready. Regards, John in Lake Worth.
Was it Huckabee?
Long time. What?
Was it Huckabee?
Mike Huckabee, right.
Okay.
Well, you Googled it.
I did.
Cheated.
Now
it's not up or down. The markets are closed today for the Goyim. They're not closed because it's Pesach. They're not closed because it was Ramadan once upon a time or because it was whatever. They're closed for Good Friday. I think this is an insult. Now, let me ask you, do non-Catholic Protestants, do they celebrate Good Friday also the way the Catholics do or not?
I don't know.
Well, we'll find out. I'm not really sure of that, if Good Friday is primarily a Catholic thing. I know the non-Catholic Goyim, they get real nervous about the Virgin Mary. All those statues, all those tchotchkes that the Catholics are real big on, you know?
Yeah.
All those graven images. Yeah, I don't know. As I go through my life, I just wonder how anybody with even an iota, with a little tiny bit of intelligence and self-respect, how they can buy into this crap, any of these religions, this man-made garbage.
Yeah, Huckabee is a Southern Baptist minister.
Who is?
Huckabee.
Yeah, I know that. And why are you pursuing that? We got the name. Now let's move on, man. Move on. Like Defoe told Rimmer. Rimmer told Defoe. Move on.
Okay.
Yeah, when there was going to be a confrontation there, Rimmer, I'll move on. Move on, yeah. I actually give Defoe a couple of points on that deal. Remember we played that yesterday? Remember that?
Yeah, that was good.
Oh, Oscar from Surbiton, England, who just bugs the hell out of me. Why didn't I block him? An email from a friend, it says, from a friend. Very funny, Oscar. Ha, ha, ha. Hope you enjoy your time off next week. You see, I still love you and care about you, even though you treat me like dirt sometimes. No, not sometimes, all the time, and that's because you're an idiot. You really should show more gratitude to the people who take their time to contact you with valuable, interesting contributions to your show. Be honest, without us, you'd struggle, wouldn't you? Not without you, Oscar. Haven't heard from you in a long time. We're doing just fine. We're doing great. Learn to embrace the fruitcakes like the top British radio talk show hosts have done. You're still quite good, but they have surpassed you. And if you take these lessons on board, you maybe get your salary back up again and look forward to long and lucrative contracts and return to megastardom. With your best interest at heart, Oscar from Surbiton, England. Yeah, great British talk show host. Say hi to the Queen, Oscar. Go look in the mirror. How are we doing with the poll there on the candy?
Let me see.
231. They're racing that peanut butter thing. I think they're doing that just to piss me off.
Could be.
Cadbury Cream Eggs, Favorite Easter Candy, 35. Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 33. And Chocolate Bunnies, 32. Three-way horse race going on there, speaking of the horses. And let me go to the racing channel to make sure that we're in touch with all this crap.
But even so, she's in cover between. It's the slow pace. She's trying to go between horses. And I felt she did a very nice job, all things considered, to actually finish third in this race. As I said, the competition was pretty...
Don't you love all these handicrappers and the way they intellectualize every move in the race? Now, I mean, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy. Take a hat pin. Oh, those guys, that's Aqueduct. Only 50 minutes till the first race at Aqueduct. And an hour and 6 minutes till the first race at Gulfstream. Who's our contestant? Craig.
Craig the Chronic.
We got $50 to win for what?
Craig the Chronic.
Craig the Chronic. We got $50 to win for him on the one, Nicole Song, with Javier Castellano, who was claimed last time out in the new barn, first start in the new barn, going a mile on the weeds. Larry says, hot dog heaven is great. My wife grew up in Chicago. We've gone there for almost 30 years now. I'm a junior Alta Cocker like you. You remember Jewish soul food restaurant Brian Cox tried to start years ago? No. I believe it was called Yo Mama Liga. Is that sad or what?
Yeah.
Have a great vacation no matter where you go, be it Minsk, Kishinev, or Bialystok. This Larry. Have you ever been to Sicilia? No, I've never been. Flown over it, of course, but never been there. Biggest thrill of my 5 trips to Italy has been to Savoca and Forza di Agro, two location sites of the Godfather film. Bar Vitelli in Savoca, quite interesting. Owner is Mamma Maria, now 85. Mamma Maria. Not to be confused, of course, with...
Mamma Mia!
With Mamma Mia. She said Al Pacino was a pain. He couldn't speak in Italian. She really didn't like... I don't know. She really liked Coppola much better, or didn't. I don't know. In closing, as they say in Palermo, si benedica. What does that mean?
Don't know.
This email area is just... I mean, it started out good with the hot dog heaven. That was fine. And then he started trying to be funny. What have I always told you? There's nothing worse in the world, in the entire universe, there's nothing worse than somebody trying to be funny who's not. Leary. And speaking of being funny, here's one from Tiger Tamer. Who do you like to win the Masters this weekend? Oh, God. I hear you talking about horse racing, but not much about golf. I would think that because 95% of your audience is male and at least half of them play golf, you might want to talk more about this great sport. It's not a sport. It's a game. The TV ratings don't lie. Golf is huge. Well, go watch it. Go watch it, Tiger Tamer.
Yeah.
In fact, on my cable here, I got the, where is it? What channel is it? I'll find it.
Yeah, golf is in huge. Tiger's hood. He's huge.
The golf. What?
Golf is in huge. Tiger's huge.
Restless tonight when he sleeps, I can tell you that. And this hole will make you restless. 505 yards, dog leg right.
Oh, yeah. When I go to bed, I'm worried about dog leg right, dog leg left. I'm restless. I'm wondering in my mind. I think golf is a religion to a lot of people. Boring, ponderous, and even worse than playing it is watching other people play it. Oh. Help me. Please give me some help.
Hi, this is G. Gordon Liddy, and they don't come any worse than Neil Rogers.
Jesus Christ, for extra strength, Dexedrine.
When you're getting crucified, the last thing you need is a headache. There's so much pressure. Hanging around with the whole world's sins weighing on your shoulders. And then some f***ing gladiator sticks a spear in your side.
Yeah!
Jesus Christ, that hurts. So when this thorny crown feels like a vice around my head... That's when I reach for Dexedrine. Well, I don't reach for it.
Hey! Anybody got any Dexedrine? Hey, Judas! Could you throw a couple into my mouth? Come on, I'm the savior for Christ's sake!
Extra strength Dexedrine. Because a headache is a heavy cross to bear.
1217, how insensitive and grotesque and inappropriate that was. I like it, though.
Yep.
That was by request also. Tom Jones, the song was, you people don't know your Tom Jones or your music, Sex Bomb. Don't you remember that song?
I don't know.
Come on. Doesn't bring back any memories? No?
No.
Oh. And, of course, this is the Tom Jones who's like 110 years old. He's about as sexy as a prune, as a 10-times-chewed prune. Dogma. Now we're getting... Now, did you say you liked Dogma, or did somebody else say that?
I said I liked it, and somebody ripped me for liking it.
Well, here's Paulie says, couple locations in Miami, great Chicago-style dogs. Dogma.
Yeah, it's good.
So, believe who you want. Believe this guy and Flea, or the other guy who said, bleh, bleh. Rudy says, Flea is wrong. The Republican candidates for the 2008 presidential election, a question was posed, how many of you don't believe in evolution?
Okay, that was it.
Three hands that went up, including indicating they did not believe in evolution, were former Governor Mike Huckabee of Arkansas, Representative Tom Tancredo of Colorado, and Senator Sam Brownback of Kansas, three real flat-earth lunatics. Thanks, Rudy.
There you go.
You were wrong.
Sorry.
You made a mistake. You made a mistake.
Maybe Mike Rosenthal will come there from UM and slap you around a little bit.
You made a mistake.
Ow!
W News Time is 3:22. I'm Mike Rosenthal.
Oh, those were the days. Wow. I really could write a book. The only problem is nobody would be interested, but I would be. Everybody's always telling me, oh, you should write a book about your 34 million years in broadcasting, especially in South Florida.
Yeah.
But nobody would buy it. Oh, let me get off this golf crap. Jesus, God, talk about boring.
Maybe get a price home here. I'm going to go with the one decadent man who I thought I had a little bit of trouble last time out. Let's go back and take a look at the race here on April 4th.
Oh, not take a look at it. Look in your speakers and you'll see.
Take a look at the pan down the backstretch and then the head onto the backstretch. And we see a decadent man who's in the familiar Randy Broussard silks there dropping back a little bit.
Yeah, dropping back, puking his guts. 243 votes on the poll. My favorite Easter candy is, I'm only reading the top few here, Cadbury Cream Eggs, 38. Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 34. Chocolate Bunnies, 32. I Don't Eat Candy, 25. Jelly Beans, 22. Marshmallow Peeps, 22. And Malted Chocolate Easter Eggs, 20. Well, I do love malted.
Me too.
Malt balls. Mm. Huh?
Whoppers.
Yeah, Whoppers, that's right. I've had some Whoppers in the last few months. No, they have them over at the Chinese market. They have them in a little box.
Yeah, those are
Whoppers.
Good.
Of course, most of their stuff is stale. Oh. Is there anything in the world worse than stale candy?
No.
Not too many things. Stale. The only thing worse than that is ice cream that's melted and then refrozen and melted again and refrozen. Ugh. They have a lot of that over there in the no-speaking-English market, too.
Yeah, I guess that freezer burn taste? Ugh.
No, man. Caca. And especially when you nuke it like I do, you know. And you have a high hopes. And then you realize that the outside, there's more ice cream on the outside of the carton than there was on the inside. It's all running. It's mushalid. Mike says there's a dive off Commercial Boulevard just east of I-95 called East Coast Burrito Factory. Terrific hot dogs and massive burritos. Have a great vacation. Mm. Well, I've seen a few massive burritos in my time. How do we get into this hot dog thing? All I did was mention that place there on Sunrise.
But I'm getting hungry. I'm getting hungry, though, all this food talk.
I got some weenies in the refrigerator. I could, like, nuke one up here during the next break.
Nice.
And eat on the air and get Ben Schmeagle all upset.
Now, you do no bun, right? You just eat the hot dog?
I know who?
You don't use a bun, right? You just do the hot dog?
Oh, no, I don't eat buns. The only time I ever eat buns is when I go to Mickey D's, which I, for a long time there, I just ate the meat and I wasn't eating the bun. It doesn't really make that much difference, I'm discovering, on my blood sugar. I don't know why. But I'm going to tell you, anybody who knocks the double cheeseburger or says, hold the cheese at Mickey D's is an idiot. Their taste is in their tuchus. I'm not saying this is gourmet cuisine, okay, or one of the greatest things. But the double cheeseburger, now, do you eat them at Mickey D's?
No, I haven't been to McDonald's in a while.
Why do you say it with such contempt?
Did I? I didn't mean to.
Well, you sure did. It's one of our very fine sponsors here on WQM, by the way.
Yeah, let me tell you, their fries are like crack, man. I can't get enough of them.
They're like crack.
Yeah, they're addictive.
I thought you said they were like crap.
No, they're good.
Crack. I don't eat fries.
No?
Oh. See, I select my carbs very unwisely, but nevertheless, I select it by taste, and I don't like fries all that much. Ice cream I like. Candy I love. But fries? Eh. Well, what's the big deal with fries? What is the big simmons? Why are they so, everybody's so, and like the Dutch, they're on the Damrak in Amsterdam, man. They line up for those damn French fries.
Don't they dip them in mayonnaise, too?
Oh, would you stop?
Ugh.
Oh. Yeah, we all saw that movie, yeah. They put mayonnaise, and also they have this brown sauce that looked like it came from the Amstel River. Or one of the canals. Brown sauce. In fact, Joe Bell could probably relate to it this week. Leo, who is John ZTR. I thought John ZTR already admitted to being Leo Austin. Fake. Goldie was great today. Great. O'Neill, I haven't written to you in a long time, but I just felt the need to do so on this momentous occasion.
Ow!
Yesterday, Goldie filled in for Jim Mandich, as you know. I was in pure ecstasy. It was as if heaven and earth had met. Goldie's great broadcasting voice coupled with talk of sweaty men in their balls.
Ow!
I'll tell you, Neil, it doesn't get better than that. Goldie is great. He is a pure eargasm. What a joy. Goodbye and take care. I know you hate Goldie. Goldie or Goldie, as you call him, but please just face the fact. Goldie is a better broadcaster and better person than you in every way. Does Goldie still have his hair? Check.
Ow!
Does Goldie have a better voice? Check.
Ow!
Does Goldie keep me glued to the radio? Check.
Ow!
Was Goldie cursed with handsome good looks? Check.
Ow!
Just face it, Neil. Goldie is great and what we all aspire to be. They say on the sixth day, God created man, and he took the seventh day off to come up with Goldie, the perfect human. Wow, very bad, John ZTR, very weak. Trying to resurrect old fake characters that he already outed himself on. That's sad. It's tragic. Some of these people are trying way too hard, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Andy in Pembroke Pines said, in honor of Easter, please play the rapping Bible. Flea is okay, but George kicks ass. Enjoy your time off. George kicks ass, and enjoy your time off.
Yep.
I'm going to Berlin. See, that's the one great thing when you have credit cards mm-hmm. and you have a passport. You can basically get on a plane and go anywhere.
Yeah.
And just vanish. Well, whatever happened to that old Neil Rogers? I don't know. Doesn't that sound like fun?
Yeah. I've never been to Berlin.
Oh, Berlin's great. Great food, beautiful people, and what's not to like? And lots to see. Tim says, Dogma's great if you want to pay $9 for a hot dog. East Coast Burrito is good. I also like Chipotle, a chain, but very good.
Yeah, it's good.
Is it?
Yeah.
And what is with that all of a sudden? Where the hell did that come from? All that Chipotle this and hot pepper sauce. All
right?
That. Well,
it's everywhere, isn't it? Like, all these sauces now have it. I know, it's crazy. I was saying
the
other day.
I'm going to tell you, if you want to buy stock, I don't know who makes Preparation H, but if you want to invest in some company, there's one. Going to be a lot of people with burning roids. In fact, we got a bit called Burning Roids, but we can't play it because it's got sounds in it. Says, hey, Neil, if Lee is a vegetarian, how come he's eating hot dogs? Whoever said you were vegetarian?
No, I am. Now.
You are?
I am now, yeah.
You're a vegetarian? But why is that?
I don't know. It was a bet, and I stuck with it. It's a long story. Long, boring story.
How long have you been doing this?
A couple years.
Oh. About the same time that Jolly Joe Bell's been a QAM.
Coincidence?
Starting to put the dots together.
It's Friday, you bastard.
Well, a couple of years ago, I made some money I didn't pay taxes on.
The government's got plenty of money. They don't need your taxes.
Dramatically higher taxes.
It starts with
migraines, and I know why. The headaches always come around tax time. Keep that in mind. Gotta fill in the lines and get it in on time. All I know, tax forms are a pain to think. And filling them out, man, it really stinks. I'm doing all this so they can take my pay. Yes, take half away. It's so unreal, but a fact you know. I'm in a matrix of pencils and numbers and notes. Lost half my receipts long ago. How I'll ever get through this, I just don't know. Makes me want to cry, and even though I tried, it all fell apart right from the start. What it means to me, it's just misery. April 50 C. Tried so hard and didn't get.
get far, but in the end, someone will fix this matter. Hate to call, cause after all, in the end, there wasn't to be better.
Income tax time coming up.
The burden of taxes has shifted from the wealthy to the middle class.
That sucks.
Yeah. Life sucks. 12:31 at 560 WQM. Happy Friday. Good Friday. Wow. And happy Pesach. Aziz and Pesach. I guess I better play that, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Have Aziz and Pesach.
So thanks for calling, lady. She sleeps with the fishes. She's no longer with us. Several years now. She was a sweetheart. See, the good people die, and the bastards like Joe Bell, they live forever. He'll outlive all of us.
You think so?
I don't know. I hope not.
I don't think so.
He's evil. Well, why do you say that? He's fat.
Yeah.
And he's got some kind of a pee-pee problem. Doesn't he?
He did.
When he first came here, he had some surgery or something.
Mm-hmm.
They tried to, like, tie one on. Didn't work. Kept falling off. John ZTR. You see, I mentioned him, and here he is. Didn't admit, though, by the way, to being the fake Geldy lover, but he already fessed up to that. It's lame. He says, thanks to the listener who brought up the East Coast Burrito Factory. Great burritos. The place is small, but the tacos are great. And here comes the worst part of this email. Just tragic.
Okay.
Tragic. By the way, has Flea ever thought about making a message board for WQAM? This way you can see listener feedback and people can discuss what sucks and what doesn't. That line there sucked. And we don't need to have a message board to decide it. Message board. Oh, like a chat room.
Right.
You know, way back in the beginning, once upon a time, long ago, on our website, we tried that whole thing with the chat room.
Yeah.
And it's like all chat rooms. They don't even talk about the show or anything to do with us, unless they want to rip us an ass, me and George. And they get into a peeing contest with each other.
Right.
That's what all those things turn into.
Why don't they start their own website then?
Don't know chat, no whatever he said. Okay, bad idea, John ZTR. Only for really sick groupies like you, with no lives.
I have no lives.
Jesus God. Listener feedback is what the email is for. Isn't that why we're doing the emails?
Right.
So they can actually say something. What sucks? What doesn't suck? What they like? What they hate? As if we care. If you like eating Mexican fast food, says Fat Boy in Lauderdale, who's getting really chronic and annoying, I recommend Tijuana Flats. I find it to be better than Chipotle and Burrito Factory. There's one on Commercial and Tamarack. I recommend the Mega Juana Burrito Wet, which means with cheese sauce over it. Check it out sometime. No, I won't check it out.
No.
Would you check it out?
No.
No, you won't check it out because you're vegetarian now.
I've seen that place.
You don't miss?
Oh, I do, of course. There's things I miss.
So what are you accomplishing? Is it a health thing or...
Yeah, it's a little bit of health. Not so much health,
ethical
really.
Thing?
Yeah, kind of just, yeah, my beliefs about.
Your beliefs about what?
Eating living things.
How about eating dead things?
Oh, yeah, there you go.
Here's one. Are you up to the... Oh, this is, yeah. I know you're old, but open yourself up with new technology. Do you or Flea have the following? An iPod? Yes.
Yeah.
A TiVo? Yes.
Yeah.
A Blu-ray player? No.
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
See, there you are. I know you're old, but open yourself up to a new technology. I got all the stuff I want.
Yeah, I think you're very advanced.
Got my crackberry sitting here, which I'm never without. I mean, what's not to like? Wait till you hear this story.
Okay.
You know, considering it's Good Friday, I thought it was going to be... I mean, I'm not saying that the emails have been great. But... There's just enough stuff to, and of course the 1 to 2 hours, a lot of that horse racing stuff.
Right.
The Gulfstream stuff, which I know that everybody in the audience is just enthralled with, you know. Hey, listen, it's a commercial enterprise, and that's what we're here for, is to make a buck or two. That's what Joe Bell said.
12.
Race 2.
Race 3 has no changes.
Oh, it just had the changes there for race 2, and I missed it.
Race 4 kicks off the pick 6
the
with a carryover of $3,511. Scratch number 7, would and could. Number 7 is...
Yeah, scratch this. So, there you go. Just to let you know that it's on there. HPI.
Okay.
Horse Player Interactive. Too bad you guys can't see the races, unless you're at the track. Now, were you at the track? Was it last Friday?
No, I wasn't.
But the week before that. Seems like only yesterday that George was out there. Don't you remember the day that we couldn't get in touch with him? The Beast was here, that's right.
Right.
The Beast was on your end, and George was out there, and until right till we came on the air, we couldn't hear George. They were having some line issues. But yeah. Then again, we don't have any technical issues at QAM because we are something. A decorated ex-cop who claimed he tested positive for cocaine because he ingested the drug during oral sex with his girlfriend can't have his job back, a Manhattan judge has ruled. Supreme Court Justice Eileen Rackauer last month shot down helicopter pilot John Golden's attempt to overturn his April 2008 dismissal from the NYPD. Golden, a 15-year veteran, tested positive for cocaine in October 2006 in a random drug test using hairs from his arm.
Wow.
How come they didn't use hairs from his...
rectum.
Golden, an adherent of the straight-edge lifestyle that rejects substance use, didn't challenge the drug test.
Hmm.
He sued last year after a state appeals court rejected the NYPD's use of hair to test for illegal drug use. This is a very special human being who devoted his entire life to being a police officer, said lawyer Paul Goldberger. He would no more use drugs than the man on the moon. The man on the moon. Cockamoon. Golden's lawsuit said the cocaine in his system was the product of passive ingestion from performing oral sex on girlfriend Corrine McCarthy, who once he tested positive admitted that she was a regular cocaine user. She never told Golden about her drug use, court records say. The couple met at a punk concert, and according to court records, they would often sweat while having sex three or four times a week. Sweat hogs.
Yeah.
They split immediately once Golden tested positive for cocaine. More than 70 friends went to bat for the ex-cop, saying they never had seen him take even a sip of coffee, and that he abstained at bars while others drank booze. Clearly, the wrong result was reached in this case, Goldberger said. This guy should be a cop.
Yeah.
However, Rackauer ruled that even though the appeals court put a stop to hair test in December 2000-something or other, Golden's firing must stand because he voluntarily cooperated with a drug test and allowed hair samples to be taken from his arm. I wonder if they pull it out with the tweezers, you think?
I don't know.
Ouch.
I'm not buying a story, though.
The state's highest court Tuesday agreed to hear an appeal from the NYPD in favor of hair testing, which the city began using in 2005. I wonder if they pluck them out with the tweezers. How about your eyebrows? Can they pluck one of those out with a tweezer and test your eyebrows?
Sure.
Whatever. Jeff Moss says, show is great as always. Hope you don't go the way of the dodo via automated shows. George Flea, Fat Chris, our good radio. Two things. The Panthers haven't been any good since Jeff Moss and his olive suit left the Miami Arena. This is from Jeff Moss, by the way, who signs it to fake Brian Scrudland. And Wayne H. is still Joyce. On a more happy note, have located the hideout of one Prozac Ron, your friend. It's a good Friday indeed. He sleeps with a gefilte fish. All the best, says Jeff Moss. He used to work for the Panther organization. He was one of the PR guys, you know?
Really?
Him and his brother. I forget what his brother's name was. Long time ago, back in the old Miami Arena days. You ever go to a game in the old Miami Arena?
No.
You won't anymore. It's long gone. Just like the new Marlins Stadium. It's not even built yet, and someday it'll be long gone. Let's just keep building arenas and stadiums. I think it's a really a tremendous use of tax funds.
Yeah.
Oh, I saw this story. I think it was on our website, or maybe I didn't. Maybe it wasn't important enough to put it on, about the old lady who tried to break up a sword fight.
What?
Yeah, we'll get to it. She's dead, by the way. The lesson for all you kids out there, don't try to break up sword fights unless you want to get speared. The Chipotle restaurant is either currently owned or previously owned and run by McDonald's, says Joe from Palmetto Bay. Did you know that?
I did not.
Now, do they have vegetarian stuff in these places, or are you just...
Yeah, yeah they do.
They do.
Mm-hmm.
Like what?
Black bean burritos.
Oh, like I said. Oh,
O'Neal.
You get a lot of big sports with Neil Rogers on Sports Hole Radio, WQAM.
Hello, this is Robert Iger, president and CEO of the Walt Disney Company.
Hello.
Hello?
Trying to reach the phone. Hold on.
Diane, is this you? Diane, is that you?
Hello. Diane.
Diane.
Is this Diane Sawyer?
No, it's not Diane Sawyer. Why would Diane Sawyer be calling on this number?
Oh. Mr. Mouse?
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God, you're alive.
Oh.
Are you okay?
I don't know where I am.
I haven't seen you since your 80th birthday party.
Last thing I remember, I was in a pickup truck with Teabag from Prison Break.
Sir, do you have any idea where you are?
I'm in a warehouse.
You're in a warehouse?
And I'm chained to a dead hooker.
And you're chained to a dead hooker?
And there's a puppet sitting in the corner.
And there's a puppet sitting in the corner.
Stop repeating everything I say, Eisner.
It's Iger, sir. Sir, why are you chained to a dead hooker?
Why would I know the answer to that question, Eisner?
Iger, sir.
I think the puppet has already read some sort of message aloud, and there appears to be an iron mask locked around my head.
Sir, it sounds like you're in Saw 6.
What?
You know the movie Saw?
No way.
Yeah.
They're making another one?
I don't know.
Last one did pretty good.
Yeah, no, it was pretty good, pretty scary.
Well. Listen, try to get me out of here. I think I've lost my left leg. And I'm laying here in a... I can't really see, but it certainly smells like vomit.
Sir, do you have any clue where you are?
Well, the hooker's definitely from Honduras, so I would start there.
Sir, how do you know the hooker's from Honduras?
Because I can feel the big hair cloud down there.
I don't follow, sir.
Initiate tracking device.
Initiate tracking device?
There's a tracking device implanted in my left ear. Yeah, put it in there years ago.
Okay, well,
the button to initiate, it's under my desk. Get over to my office.
Okay.
Initiate the tracking device.
Okay, we'll do,
but
sir.
But you better hurry.
Okay, I will do, sir.
I don't know how long I can last. Hey, had some party, huh?
That was a great party, sir. Thank you for
man,
the invite.
Oh, man, I know how to throw a party.
Yeah, great party.
By the way, do me a favor.
Okay.
Cancel that dirty, sexy money and that pushing daisies, huh?
Sir, you're chained in a warehouse to a dead hooker.
I've lost my leg.
And you lost your leg.
I've lost my leg.
Yeah.
I'm leaning against a hair cloud.
You mentioned that.
Cancel those two shows.
Sir, are you sure you're in the right condition to be canceling programs
on
the network?
I'm a businessman! Even chained to a dead hooker in Honduras, missing a leg and bleeding out. I know those shows suck!
Okay.
End them!
Okay.
And hurry up and find me where. I think the mask is tightening.
Oh, no.
Oh.
I'm going to go run to your office and initiate the tracking device.
I don't care. You don't have to tell me what you're going to do. Just do it before I bleed out.
Okay. By the way, happy birthday.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate the watch.
You're welcome.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Oh, you like that?
I love them.
See, that's the one great thing about the Mickey bits. They're all long, real long. That one is goes on forever.
Yeah.
How long is it? 3.5 minutes.
Still funny, though.
Let's play it again if you liked it.
Sure.
Now, here's a pathetic email. Obviously trying to be amusing.
Mm-hmm.
But from somebody who's so stupid, they don't even know that I'm on the QAM, not IOD. This is just pathetic. Greg says, O'Neill, I don't want to sound like a lifeless loser, but when you go on vacation, our entire day is disrupted. I hate to say it, but we don't like to listen to George because he always sounds so depressing. We have scheduled our days around the 10 to 2 hour, and I just want you to know when you're gone, we listen to TV or DVDs or nothing. We schedule our days around the 10 to 2 hour. That was the operative part of this email.
Right.
I hope you totally enjoy your vacation wherever you go. I hope you have a great time away from WIOD. I really think WIOD is sabotaging your show. You ought to see the way he spells sabotaging.
Okay.
I say they should go F themselves.
Wow.
Stay well, Neil. Have fun, and we love you. Miss you already and can't wait for you to come home safely. Sincerely, Karen and Greg feels the same way. Whoever Karen and Greg are. Oh.
By the way, fact check, McDonald's no longer owns Chipotle. They got rid of it in 2006.
Well, good for them.
Yeah.
I still say the Mickey D's double cheeseburgers are awesome. I was having a couple the other day. Two. I can't eat only one.
You ate two? Wow.
I always have two. Well, why do you say it was
such
shock?
I guess the double cheeseburgers aren't as big. I was thinking of the double quarter pounder with cheese.
No, quarter pounder with cheese, my ass. Two double cheeseburgers, they're not that big.
No.
can't eat only one.
Yeah.
And I was sitting there, and I was like, I looked at it. I looked, instead of just eating it, I looked, you know, in the inside, the guts of it.
Really?
And I thought to myself, this is hog heaven. I mean, you're not eating meat anymore, so.
Yeah.
I don't understand that whole deal about eating meat.
Well. It's not for everyone.
So what do you eat?
I eat,
Salads?
Yeah, I eat salads, a lot of pizza, a lot of pastas, vegetables, obviously, tofu, soy.
Choy?
Yeah. I'm not a vegan, so I eat eggs and cheese and stuff, you know. I love cheese.
Hey, to each its own. Whatever turns you on, man. Whatever makes you happy.
That's right. That's why I don't preach about, you know, vegetarianism. I don't care. Eat what you want. What do I care?
A 77-year-old woman, this is in Indianapolis, suffered a fatal stab wound while trying to break up a sword fight Thursday between her grandson and brother-in-law, police said. An autopsy determined Franziska Stegbauer died of a wound from one of the swords, Police Sergeant Matthew Mount said. Both men were hospitalized with stab wounds. One of them was critically hurt. We're unsure yet who started this fight, but how the sword play got involved, Mount said. We're not sure who it was who stabbed the woman. We'll have to do some testing on the swords and figure out who had which sword, whose blood is on which sword. One of the weapons was a WW2-era Japanese officer's sword with a thin blade. The other had a thicker blade, Mount said. Police placed Stegbauer's grandson, 39-year-old Chris Rondu, under arrest on a preliminary charge of attempted murder. Stegbauer's brother-in-law, 69-year-old Adolf Stegbauer, suffered several serious stab wounds, police said. Franziska Stegbauer was not breathing when officers arrived around 1 a.m. at the home on the city's northwest side, and she was later pronounced dead at the hospital.
Yeah, not breathing is a good sign. She's dead.
Adolf Stegbauer was listed in critical condition at Wishard Hospital, a spokesman said. I wonder if that's named after Barry Wishard, the make-believe harness driver from 100 years ago.
It's not every day you stumble across a sword fight.
Yeah, not your everyday kind of stuff.
No.
Rondo also was taken with stab wounds to Wishard. Police said he was alert at the scene, but a condition update was not immediately available, and I'm sure we're hanging on. This is at 12:39 this afternoon I got this. Although the story was in, I had it on our thing. He was being held in the hospital's detention unit. Sword fights. There's something for all you kids out there. Get some swords. A little dueling. It's an honorable thing. Isn't it supposed to be honorable?
Yeah.
Dueling. Who was it, Aaron Burr and Raymond Burr?
Yeah. Wait, Raymond
I think
Burr.
What started that one is when Aaron told Raymond...
You fairy!
That. Baron Fitz says, go to my hometown. This is a suggestion for my vacation.
Okay.
San Francisco. No, I've been there, done that. No thanks. Great food, nice people. The weather's pretty good this time of the year. Close enough to Tahoe, Reno if you get the Schlotz urge. We'll never go back there, Frisco. Hated it.
Really?
Weather was horrible. Always cold. Windy, cold.
Yeah.
Bitter. A lot of clones running around, you know, silly queens with the clone mustaches, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe not anymore. Maybe it's changed. I haven't been there in a long time, and I'm not going back.
I was there 2 years ago.
And?
No, last year, actually, I was there, yeah. Pretty much the same as you described it.
Miami Herald has a front page story today about abuse at Pompano Park, says the fake Jim DeFetis. More Eisner, please. No, no chance. No more Eisner. See, I play one of those, and right away, oh, let's hear all those. Dana says another ass clown bashing George. Dana just keeps, since he changed his name, he's just all over the place here. Now, there's a front page story on the Herald today about Pompano Park. Let me see if I can find it. I don't see it yet. You see it?
I'm getting there now.
I don't see a damn thing about Pompano Park. Well, let me Google it. Because the fake Jim DeFetis may be full of crap, you know?
Could be.
Okay, I'm searching. Let's see. For Pompano Park, horsemen, slots are not paying off. That's the story. Good. Thank you, fake Jim DeFetis, or real one, whoever you are. Yeah, they're not paying off because the Isla Capri screwed them. That's why. That whole deal over there is screwed up. You been to Pompano Park?
I have.
Oh, boy. Talk about taking an opportunity and doing something dead-ass wrong. Isle of Capri. They're the experts at it.
Yep.
Now, let me print this out right now. Do you hear it pushing out there?
Yep.
I felt something pushing out about 40 minutes ago, but that was a little different. For Pompano Park horsemen, slots are not paying off, says Michael Vasquez. Like many in the local horse industry, Pompano Park trainer driver Michael Dieters pushed hard to bring slots to South Florida's Paramutuals. Oh, this is long. I better... Oh, good. And this will be a good segue right into our Gulfstream segment, the 1 to 2 hour.
Yeah.
For Craig and the one horse, Nicole Song, in the second race at Gulfstream. I think I saw the two was scratched in the second race. Maybe one of our astute, because Steve Sloan don't do nothing anymore.
Well, I sent him a text asking if there was any scratches. He hasn't replied yet.
The 2 and the 12, I believe. I turned it on just as they were flipping over to the third race changes.
Yeah, that was only a second first-time starter that's won on the turf in five years. That's pretty amazing, but he has very good...
Oh, Tempest Storm. I wonder if she's still performing at the Pussycat Theater. Tempest Storm, name of the three horse. 6-5 favorite. I wonder if she still has that fake apparatus that she used to wear. Ever hear of Tempest Storm?
No.
Old stripper, about 10,000 years old. 290 votes on the poll about your Easter candy. I still can't get over the... Oh, and look what's number one. They're just doing that to piss me off. Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs is number one, tied for first.
Mm-hmm.
They're just doing that because I despise them.
Oh, you're listening to Neil Rogers.
The 1 to 2 hour.
You're fired. You need to pack up your things and go.
It is not a good time for me to lose my job.
I think it's the way my boss told me.
Hey, happy birthday. You're fired.
They no longer need me working there.
You're fired.
Well, guess who's been fired?
I have been fired.
Whatever.
I've been replaced by some computer software. Let go a month before my incredible bonus was due. Yo, that's fine.
Well, ain't this a kick in the ass?
I'm in the unemployment line.
Unattached, unemployed, and living with his father.
Yo, that's fine.
You dirty son of a bastard.
I'm in the unemployment line.
Inhuman.
Oh.
The boss, you sick bastard.
Everybody's out of work. Nobody's got any money, but it's Good Friday.
Ow!
All right. I don't get it.
Mm-mm.
I think they just showed the first race at Woodbine. Pretty damn sure. Not that we care about that. And the 10 and the 12 are the scratches in the second race at Gulfstream. I looked it up online.
Okay.
Since Steve Sloan ain't giving us no assistance.
Nope.
10 and the 12 are out. Rob says, and I think Rob's full of it, I love when people say, I heard. My mother used to say, well, you know what they say? And I'd say, well, who are they?
Right.
Well, you know what they say? Rob says, I heard that McDonald's no longer puts two slices of cheese in their double cheeseburger because it saves them 10 cents a sandwich. I think you're full of it, Rob. Here they put two slices of cheese. I had a couple just the other day. And I'm pretty dang sure there were. Now, next time I get one, I'm going to make sure I look. It says, if this is true, I will no longer buy it. I love their double cheeseburger, and I think this is tragic. Well, I think it's tragic that you're repeating a rumor that somebody started giving you a song and a dance. In addition to which, do you think it would save them 10 cents a sandwich on with a slice of cheese? When you buy in the quantity that a place like Mickey D's would buy,
right.
Do you think that it would cost you a dime?
No way.
For a slice of that American cheese?
Cheese food.
Well, whatever, but I'm just saying, do you think it would cost you a dime? Rob, I think you got a hearing problem, man. I think you got to go get some Q-tips. Stick your head in a pencil sharpener. Clean your ears out. Mike says, just an idea for a trip. Why not select a location in Asia? Never been to Asia, have you?
Nope.
In your discussions over the years, don't recall you ever mentioning visiting any spots in this region. That's because I haven't. Personally, my favorite is Singapore, with Shanghai being a close second. Both have a European flair sprinkled in with their Asian culture. Especially in Singapore, you get the European influence, plus those hot Aussies running around. Not to get food-intensive, my favorite place is Moe's Southwest Grill. Their burritos blow away Chipotle's processed garbage, says Mike.
Wow.
How do you like that? You ever hear of Moe's Southwest Grill?
I have. There's one off of the 17th Street Causeway on Cordoba.
You never been there?
No.
Well, we'll get some reports, I'm sure of that. I'm thinking of that, although maybe we won't. Like we didn't get any report about, what's the song, Tom Jones?
Yeah.
Sex Bomb.
Sex Bomb.
That was the name of the song. Sex Bomb. Never heard that song?
No. I remember he redid Prince's Kiss. That was pretty bad.
He did what?
The song Kiss by
Kiss?
Prince. Yeah, he redid it. Bad.
Well, he is bad. But he's old and lovable now, Tom Jones. He's old and cuddly and silly.
And furry.
At least 200 years old. For Pompano Park horsemen, slots are not paying off. It says, like many in the local horse industry, Pompano Park trainer-driver Mike Dieters pushed hard to bring slots to South Otis Paramutuals. Back in 2004, when voters were asked to approve a state constitutional amendment paving the way for slots, Dieters handed out pro-slots literature at his son's elementary school in Coconut Creek. Dieters and the rest of Pompano's largely working-class horsemen contributed $100,000, money they had to borrow to the slots campaign. The referendum passed, but the expected windfall for horse workers never arrived, Dieters said. We got pimped on the legislation, he said. That's the gist of it. They got pimped. As the Florida legislature considers a proposal to expand slot-like machines to paramutuals statewide, the case of Pompano Park, nowadays more known by the name of its new slots casino, The Isle, is a cautionary tale. Though The Isle is the busiest of Broward's three slot racinos, Pompano's purses, the method by which horsemen are paid, haven't doubled like park management said they would during lead-up to the public vote. Nationally, slots are often touted as a way to keep struggling paramutuals afloat, but once installed, the slots frequently become the main attraction. Glitzy new slots rooms receive fine dining restaurants, other amenities, while the older horse racing, dog racing highlight part of the business might operate in an outdated, decaying building if it keeps operating at all. Oh, yeah, just like Woodbine, not. Like Dover Downs, not. See, this is what happens when you get an idiot like Michael Beck. This is the same guy, I think, wrote the article about Mayor Robina and the comments about buggy chariot racing or whatever at Hialeah.
Could be.
It's obvious everything is 10 times better where the casino is, said Clarence Wilkins, a recent patron at Highlandale Beach's Mardi Gras Casino, which features both slots and greyhound races. Mardi Gras management says the state's high tax rates on slots leave little money for dog track updates. Upgrades. Down the street from Mardi Gras, Gulfstream Park is one of the Broward Racino that boasts a completely new look, both on the racing and casino fronts. The thoroughbred track underwent a $230 million renovation that began before the slots arrived and then tweaked to include the machines. The harness races at Pompano are less glamorous than their... Oh, here we go with that again, Michael Vasquez. You're an idiot! Less glamorous than their thoroughbred counterparts at Gulfstream, and Pompano's 45-year-old track shows its age. For example, bathrooms in the facility's new slots casino include fancy video screen mirrors that display promotional images while patrons fix their hair. Bathrooms in the racing area have water-stained ceilings and no-frills mirrors, and one, a small piece of the wall is missing. Frustrated Pompano horsemen took their pay complaints to court in 2007, but the case is still pending. Casino management have pushed back attempts in the legislature that would make a written agreement with horsemen a prerequisite to operating slots. We think we run the business and we should be able to negotiate fair purses with them, Pompano Park lobbyist Jack Skelding Jr. said. The casino shouldn't be put in the position of having to deal with them with a gun to our head. With Tallahassee lawmakers staying out of the fray, Pompano bears the distinction of being the only harness racetrack in America where slots were installed without any state legal protections to make sure horsemen received their fair share, according to the U.S. Trotting Association. South Florida's other horse racing racinos, Gulfstream and Calder, hold thoroughbred, not harness racing, but there, too, horsemen are guaranteed a share of slots money. Gulfstream horsemen receive 7% of slot revenue, with that share to go higher if the state lowers its 50% tax rate on slots. Calder has yet to install slots, but when it does, its horsemen will enjoy similar contract terms. At Pompano, the drivers and trainers work with no contract and no pay guarantees. Since slots arrived in 2007, purses have fluctuated, sometimes including slots money, sometimes not. Casino management has argued that it fulfilled its pledge to double purses. While the purses at Pompano have gone up, numbers compiled by the state's Division of Paramutual Wagering show they've nowhere near doubled. Pompano management insists slots have been a blessing for horse racing. Had slots not come to Pompano Park when they did, they wouldn't be racing horses there anymore. Vice President GM Michael Bloom said they'd be out of business. Despite the addition of slots, Bloom said the facility is still operating in the red because of its high tax rate and the debt payments required to pay off the $195 million construction tab for the new slots area and poker room. Everybody said, oh, there's going to be a giant pot of money, Bloom said. There's no money left over. Aside from the purses dispute, Pompano's horsemen complained of other broken promises. Back in 2005, Pompano's general manager pledged in writing that upon the installation of slot machines, the facility would hold at least 180 days of live racing a year. The track now holds 158. Next year, that number will drop to 143. When Pompano's horsemen cobbled together the $100,000 contribution to the pro-slots political campaign, they did so on the condition they be included in meetings with state lawmakers on the slots issue. But in court testimony, Pompano representatives readily acknowledged holding multiple meetings with lawmakers without the horsemen present. Too many to count, one Pompano official testified. One key meeting was then State Representative Jack Seiler. The racetrack was in Seiler's district, and he says he was concerned about the horsemen being treated fairly. The two sides quietly struck a deal. In exchange for Seiler not adding protections for the horsemen to a gambling bill he was sponsoring, Pompano management would increase the purses it paid. The private memorandum of understanding between Seiler and the track guaranteed purses for the 2007-08 racing season would be $12 million, which Pompano told Seiler was double the current level, except it wasn't close to double, as purses stood at roughly $8 million the previous year. Furthermore, the memorandum didn't prevent Pompano from reducing purses in the future, something the track has done since. They goosed him up and then they knocked him down again. I'm just disappointed to hear the purses have gone down. That was my intention, Seiler said, now the mayor of Fort Lauderdale. Pompano and the state's pure mutual industry in general are significant campaign donors in the legislature. During Seiler's recent successful run for mayor, several Pompano lobbyists donated to his campaign. The current Senate proposal to allow slot-like machines at Pure Mutual statewide includes a provision designed to avoid the Pompano outcome. All facilities that had machines would be required to negotiate a revenue-sharing deal with their representative dog breeders, horsemen, or highline players. But the bill, should it become law, would apply only to new racinos opening in the future, not existing slots facilities like Pompano, which has done a nightmarish job, butchering the whole concept of what it was all about. How come they do things right just about everywhere else? And in South Florida, it's always half-assed.
Yep.
Not slow, not fast, just half-assed. There's Keeneland.
Third, a gap of nearly four. Back of that one to Pollard's Babe as they come toward the quarter pole.
Got to get in the mood for the Gulfstream deal. Race one is only 4 minutes away at Gulfstream. Aren't you getting all whipped up?
Yep.
Little knot in your throat.
O'Neill! It's Friday, you bastard.
I met a priest when I was 11. He said he would save my soul. But we made a detour on the way to heaven. And into his bedroom we did take a stroll. Well, he was standing in his underwear. Told me to bend over and say a prayer. Pulled up his robe and went back, thank you, ma'am. I got molested by the preacher man behind the rectory.
Rectum?
You fairy. The next day, I felt like a sinner. And I showed up to get communion. But on my tongue, that was in a wafer. And it wasn't wine a dripping off my chin. Well, he was standing in his underwear. Told me to bend over and say a prayer. Pulled up his robe and went, man, thank you, ma'am. I got molested by the preacher man behind the rectory. Yeah, he was standing in his underwear. Told me to bend over and say a prayer. Pulled up his robe and bam, bam, thank you, ma'am. I got molested by the preacher man behind the rectory.
The 7 won the first race at Gulfstream by about 800 lengths.
All right.
Not that we care. We're not, no. We're not participating in the double and all that other stuff because we got nobody out there. And your guests, including Sleeve Sloan.
No, he finally got back to me.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he said.
He tended the 10 and 12 or scratched in the second race?
10 and 12, yep.
Yeah. Did he tell you Abe Lincoln enjoyed the play? Attaboy, Steve, you're doing it. You're right on top of it. Well, the reason I played that bit, former L.A. priest is sentenced to 3 years in prison for a sex crime. How unusual. A former L.A. priest at the center of Cardinal Roger Mahoney's unsuccessful attempts to keep Archdiocese personnel something from county prosecutors, was sentenced Friday to 3 years in prison for molesting a young boy 2 decades ago. Chopped off here on the right-hand margin, you know? All my stories are chopped off. Well, most of them. George Miller, 70, pleaded guilty in December to molesting the child between 1988 and 89, admitted to sexually abusing at least 3 other boys after the Archdiocese received its first complaint about him in 1977. My family trusted you to teach me the ways of the Lord, not the ways of the hell, one of the victims out in his 30s told Miller in a trembling voice in a San Fernando courtroom. Miller, gray-haired and spectacled, sat silently with his fist covering his mouth. A handful of supporters sat behind him in the courtroom audience. L.A. County Superior Court Judge Cynthia Ulfig ordered him to take him into custody immediately after the sentencing. After the hearing, Miller's lawyer, Stephen M. Cron, said his client had a different version of what happened, but accepted a plea to avoid a possibly lengthy prison sentence if he were convicted at trial. He had a different version of events. In the end, we decided not to contest the charges, and it's time for everyone to move on, Cron said. Just like Defoe and Rimmer, move on. Prosecutors believe that Miller molested at least six boys between 77 and 91. Deputy D.A. Anne-Marie Wise said the case would have been a challenge to bring to trial because of all the time that's passed and the difficulty the victim would have had in testifying about abuse that left him emotionally scarred. She said the outcome of the case gave victims a chance they had long sought to confront Miller in court and hear him respond to the abuse. I don't think that any amount of state prison can ever heal the victims in this case, Wise said. The DA's office initially charged Miller in 2002 with molesting several boys, but the charges were dismissed, along with more than a dozen other cases against priests or former priests, when the U.S. Supreme Court struck down a California law that extended the statute of limitations for decades-old sex abuse. And it goes on and on. Same old stuff, same old story, same old getchkes, same old people turning their kids over to priests.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the real skinny on the McDonald's thing. Since this has become a real a bone of contention, if I can say that. Can I say that?
I think
sorry,
you can.
Joyce. It's become a of contention. Mickey D's wants to hold a cheese on Dollar Menu's double burger. McDonald's Corp wants to bump its popular double cheeseburger off the Dollar Menu for a less cheesy sandwich. The Oak Brook-based fast food giant confirmed this week it's asking franchise leaders to support the new sandwich to be called the McDouble, which would have two hamburger patties and one piece of cheese.
Hmm.
Franchise leaders are recommending their colleagues vote to approve the new sandwich according to the memo obtained by Cranes, whoever Cranes is. The memo notes that the new double hamburger with one piece of cheese would sell on the Dollar Menu, while the double hamburger with two pieces of cheese would be sold at a higher price. See, they still got the two pieces of cheese, like I said, yeah, to that goofball that wrote in before. Didn't. Oh, I heard this and I heard that. Here's the real skinny right here from George in Orlando. The recommendation to add McDouble to our popular Dollar Menu reflects that we're providing our customers even more choices with the everyday affordability of our customers expect, McDonald's said in a statement. The recommendation to adjust the price of double cheeseburger allows us to continue to provide the same great-tasting burger our customers know and love, still at a great value. Franchisees are scheduled to vote on the proposal in November. Since management wants the double hamburger with cheese on the Dollar Menu, they'll ask franchisees in the field to keep voting until they get it right, said Dick Adams, a McDonald's franchisee consultant. It's up to the individual franchisees to decide how to price the classic double cheeseburger, which I expect will go from $1.19 to $1.99, depending on the area of the country. Still pretty cheap. Like a buck and a quarter for a double cheeseburger?
Not
you think
bad.
That's pretty cheap?
Yeah.
Well, you don't eat meat anyway, so what the hell do you know about
but it? But I know it's cheap.
Removing one piece of cheese will save franchises about 6 cents per sandwich. See, not a dime. See, this other guy, he heard a little bit of this story and right away got it all balled up. It notes that in test markets featuring both versions, about 60 to 70% of customers continue to order the classic double burger with two pieces of cheese. The memo to franchisees says the changes could boost cash flow by about $15,000 a year per restaurant. This sounds like a legitimate option to remove a piece of cheese, but it seems odd to offer both double cheeseburgers, said Larry Miller, an analyst in Atlanta with RBC Capital Markets. Any change to the Dollar Menu is really important because it's in such high demand now.
Ooh.
I'm gagging on it.
Yeah.
The Dollar Menu accounts for about 14% of Mickey's U.S. sales and helps bargain-hunting customers get into the restaurants. But rising food costs, which McDonald's expects to be up about 7% this year, have squeezed franchisees' profits and cash flow. McDonald's has raised prices about 4% on its main menu items this year, but has left the Dollar Menu alone. Executives said there have been no changes to the double cheeseburger price in the past 6 years. Okay, there you go. There's the real story, the story behind the story.
Yep.
6 cents, not a dime, okay? A dime for a slice of cheese. Okay, now let's take a look at the opening odds for the second race at Gulfstream, shall we?
Yes.
Who's the favorite?
I don't know.
The one, 5-2 favorite.
Uh-oh.
You bet
not
the
heavy
shock?
Favorite. The 3 is 9-2, the 6 is 4-1, and the 11 is a 9-2. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 horses getting bet. But the one open, why is it that the horse I pick always, and what's his name, Ron Nicoletti picked the something else, 5, I think. Yeah, 5, which is 7-1. How come every time I pick a horse, it opens his favorite at Gulfstream?
I don't know.
Is that the power of...
Neil, God!
Or is it more likely a coincidence, I would imagine? So there's the story on that. Here's the poll result. My favorite Easter candy is, boy, we sure got far adrift of this. We got to hot dogs and Mickey D's and Chipotle's.
Yep.
And by the way, Rudy says, Moe's sub grill sucks, at least the one in Doral. Chipotle is much better, so he don't like it.
Nope.
You know, if you ask any half dozen people about different places, you're going to get 6 different answers. Favorite Easter candy is Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs, 52. How tragic. How gag-inducing. Cadbury Cream Eggs, 49. Chocolate Bunnies, 46. I Don't Eat Candy, 37. Jelly Beans, 26. Malted Chocolate Easter Eggs, 24. Yeah, malted ones are really melted. You like melted or malted?
Both.
Malted, 24. Marshmallow Peeps, 23. Hershey Kisses, 19. Easter M&M's, 13. Cadbury Eggs, 13. I Can't Eat Any Candy, 13. Marshmallow Easter Eggs, 9. And Gummy Bunnies, still Solamente Uno, only one. Out of 325 votes, Gummy Bunnies.
Yep. The best is when you would, like, suck on the Whoppers until they collapse. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good stuff.
Yeah, if they're not stale.
Right.
They're stale. Oh, my. Horrendous. Jelly Beans is like in the middle of the pack.
Yeah.
Timothy says, Chipotle was a local Denver chain that was acquired by McDonald's like Boston Market and sold off in 2006.
Yep.
They use natural unprocessed meat and chicken, no steroids, antibiotics, etc. Moe's is ersatz, it says. Ersatz, make-believe. Moe's. You know Moe? So you never met Moe, huh?
No, unfortunately.
Wow. Boy, you sure missed the excitement. You missed the salad days.
Yeah.
Moe and Gelding.
Ow!
And boy, did they ever hate each other. I mean, despise each other. I don't know if Moe hated Geldy, but Geldy sure hated him.
And Geldy's a nice guy, so.
That's what I hear. I hear he's the great voice, great looks.
Well, I don't know about
penis.
All that.
Oh, yeah. That's what I'm hearing. That's the rumor on our emails.
O'Neill!
It's Fatwa Friday, you bastards.
If your party snacks taste like hell, this year at Christmas, serve Cheeses of Nazareth. Your guests will say, holy cow, when they bite into these sinfully rich treats. And Cheeses of Nazareth come in a variety of flavors, from jalapeno to hallelujah. Get the snack he would have liked, and the taste worth praying for. Cheeses of Nazareth. It's your salvation this Christmas. There's a Cheeses of Nazareth shop on Business Loop 80, right next to Chrysler Almighty Motors.
131 at 560, by request from Brian, who says McDonald's now offers the McDouble on their value meal. It's a double cheeseburger with just one. I just got through reading all of that.
Yep.
But this was sent probably earlier. Also, in the spirit of the season, could you play Cheeses of Nazareth, one of my favorites. You're the best, says Brian. Thank you, Brian, since we are cheese intensive.
Yeah, and you've been doing lots of requests today.
Well, why the hell not? It's, you know, it's a holiday of sorts.
Yeah.
After a fashion. Let's see how that one horse is getting bet at Gulfstream. 3-1. Still the chalk. You see, wide open race. When the favorite's 3-1, that means anybody can win. 3-horse, 4-1. 5-horse, 5-1. 6-horse, 7-2. And the 11, 5-1. So the one is a very lukewarm favorite. Lukewarm.
Should be a good race.
How do you know that?
Well, there's no one that should be blowing anybody out of the water, so.
How do you know that?
Just going by the odds, I guess.
Odd is the word. Odd is the operative word. Don't forget, we got the Big O is on today, 2-4. He's the only other one beside me working regular shift today. What a guy, huh? What a guy.
Yeah.
And then we got Geldy again. Oh. Oh, that guy is going to be squeezing himself. Geldy 4-7, Beast 8-11 tonight. And then Greg Likens, which I still don't understand that.
Yeah.
If they're making all these cutbacks, and not that I want Greg Likens to lose those 2 hours, you know. I mean, how much can they be paying him for those 2 hours? See, that's the thing that really gets me, is when they start talking about, well, we got to cut back millions and all this other crap. And then they start talking about guys like fat Chris Whalen are making like 75 cents an hour.
Right.
How much is that going to help out?
Not much.
You see what I'm saying? Pennywise and pound quarter pounder foolish. Got to do this next break just a tad early.
Okay.
Oh, here we go. Gregory Belmore. This is another John ZTR bomb. Real bad bomb. I guess he's replacing Ben. Who was the other guy?
I don't know.
Bendover? Whatever the guy's name was, the etiquette guy. Ben, I'll find it. I got to hear my poll.
Excuse me?
Here it is. Ben Schmiegel. Remember Ben Schmiegel?
Oh, yeah.
About burping and eating on the air. Well, anyway, Mr. Rogers, my records verify I have contacted you previously regarding your abominable habit of coughing and burping while on the air. I do believe there's a contrivance known as a cough button that is used by professional broadcasters to mute these nauseating noises. I suggest you use it, or I will have no choice but to go over your head to WQM management. Thank you in advance for your corrective action. Regards, Gregory Belmore, Esquire, the Belmore Building, 2400 East Commercial Boulevard, Fort Lauderdale.
Hmm.
Aren't you impressed?
No.
You're not?
Nope.
Very weak, John ZTR. Very weak. And this is a guy who wants us to put up a chat board. What do you call it?
Message board.
Message board, yeah. I got a message for you, John. That's the message. And that, too. God. Oh, you sent me this. This is really depressing news. Not that I care about that organization anyway.
Right.
Canadian pop star Celine Dion, Cirque du Soleil founder Guy Laliberté, and Quebec cable giant Quebecor Media have emerged as potential bidders for the Montreal Canadiens NHL team. The Frogs. Quebec broadcaster Radio Canada said this week that the Bank of Montreal has signed confidentiality agreements with 10 potential suitors who have until 5 p.m. Thursday, yesterday, old news you sent me,
sorry,
to submit formal bids to 80% majority owner George Gillette, Denver-based sports team and events promoter. Other interested parties include U.S. investment firm Spectrum Equity, Montreal businessman Stephen Bromfman of Claridge Investments, a cousin of Warner Music Group chairman and CEO Edgar Bromfman, and the Caisse de dépôt et placement, a provincial pension fund job, whatever the hell that means. Caisse de dépôt et placement. Frog talk. In addition to picking up the hockey team, a Canadiens buyer would acquire the Bell Centre Arena in Montreal and a concert promotion division. Gillette also owns Richard Petty Motorsports and the UK's Liverpool Soccer Club.
Wow.
Celine Dion. Oh, my God. Can she sing?
No.
Can she belt it out?
No.
Somebody ought to belt her out.
Can't stand her.
Celine Dion. I think I'm going to start a petition to get her deported from Canada. Get her out of here.
Just don't send her here.
What?
Don't send her here.
Oh, I didn't get to this. So there's a whole bunch of stuff I haven't gotten to, and we probably won't get to too much of it because we got the big race coming. Let's take a puke at the odds, man, before we do the break, which we'll do a little bit early because, the race is 9 minutes away. The one is still the favorite, 3-1, but very lukewarm favorite. 5 is 4-1, 6 is 4-1, 4 is 5-1, 11 is 7-1. Oh, the one just went to 7-2, so that's good for Craig, because if he wins, that's a $9 horse. $50 at $9 is $225.
Nice.
If the one wins.
Right.
Nicole Song with Javier Castellano. Just first race off the recent claim. Jockey change, all these things. All of these things. Who the hell knows? It's like a pig in a poke, you know what I'm saying? A lot of pressure. Next week is the last one of these we're doing?
Yeah.
A lot of pressure. Probably add like 10 years to my life.
O'Neill!
Yes. It's Friday, you bastard.
Jesus Christ. Movie star. Are you as Mel Gibson says you are?
Mel Gibson used to be the star of Lethal Weapon. Now he's making movies about the crucifixion.
Jesus Christ.
141, all the fairy tales, all the Bubba Weisses, all the time, baby. Happy Good Friday, happy Pesach, happy whatever you want to celebrate. Happy Jelly Bean Day.
Yeah.
The one is 5-2 now. He just took another hit. He's been the favorite all along.
Uh-oh.
He was as high as 7-2 and then back to 3-1. And now 5-2, he's taking late money. That's a good sign. Of course, it'd be a better sign if he crosses the finish line ahead of everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
2 minutes till post time. Gulfstream.
I'm on the edge of my seat.
Are you? No, you're not.
No.
I mean, in the beginning when we started doing this deal, the pick a pony thing, I felt like this enormous pressure, like, oh, my God, you know. But the bottom line is Chronic Craig, he ain't investing anything. It's 50 bucks we're betting for him on the one.
Yeah, he's got nothing to
lose. If he wins, he gets the money. If he loses it, nothing out of his pocket.
Right.
No sweat off his ass.
No.
Anyway, here's, Bambi says, just curious, what is a good kosher wine? The grocery stores here only carry the Manischewitz brand. Well, here's a good kosher wine, Bambi. Manischewitz or Mogen David. Those are the only two I know or ever heard of. Do you know any other kosher wines?
No.
A goyish cup like you, I'm asking about kosher wine. I don't think so.
I do like wine, though.
Do you?
Yeah.
Now, do you look for the little circle U on the label?
No, I don't care about that
Make
stuff.
Sure if it's kosher. So, in other words, you won't eat meat, but you'll eat treif.
Right. I suppose.
Although I don't know how you eat treif because you're not eating milk and meat. Well, right. What would be treif that's not, I don't know.
Well, I eat dairy, so, but yeah, I don't know. It doesn't mix with any meat, so I don't know.
Well, here's the horses on the track. And the one just went to 7-2.
Laughlin's Bridge, this one's going to step up, going to turn back today after making a really sharp inside move, and that move produced a $20,000 two-lifetime claiming
with
victory.
With a real heavy New York
mile
accent.
In the 16th, forget about right it. On this turf course, a trainer Bart.
Did Steve White do the morning show again this morning across the street?
You know, I didn't listen.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah. Said, I think this horse is going to run well and make it two in a row. Elvis Trujillo will be in the saddle this afternoon.
See, he picks the
horse
five.
That's been taking some money, actually.
One is 3-1 again.
Right. Now, and that's the 3-5 Hail Marys. And if you look for a little bit of a hunch play on Easter weekend, you might want to go with this horse, 5 Hail Marys. Some of the horses back there kicking the back wall and scaring the other horses. Couldn't see who it was. Looked like maybe it was the number 2 horse, Holiday Blaze. Not liking that saddling and clothes, and they got him walking around right now. Getting back to the number 3 horse near 5 Hail Marys. This is an interesting horse. He's going to debut on the turf.
I think Fredo did 5
really
Hail Marys. Didn't help.
$10,000 two-lifetime claiming victory. Comes back. He runs a pretty nice second against this same caliber competition. That's a mile on a sealed sloppy track. The trainer is Chad Brown. Excuse me. He's pretty good.
Boy,
with,
he's choked up on this.
I guess he doesn't have a cough button.
The turf, so thinking this horse can run well. And we'd be remiss if we didn't mention that number 1 Nicole Song. This one moved to the Peter Waldobon. That should be right
enough
right
here
to pique your interest. Via the claiming route, he went to the Peter Waldobon. He stalked the pace. He retreated. He finished 5th. That was, again, similar on February 20th.
I'm going to take the 2.
Trainer Walder, 31% with new claims. Javier Castellano will be in the saddle this afternoon. There you see the number 8, Glacial Breeze.
They're going in the gate. Shut him up already.
Looks like he's calm and cool and relaxed. And right behind him, the number 9, 7-2 Offset. Whatever the heck that means, but it's the name of the horse there. And there you see number 11, Ski Sky, going through your picture. Everyone, as I glance around, looks like they're calm and composed.
Are you
and
sure?
The jockeys are coming down to get the call.
They're off.
They're off.
One got away nice.
Laughlin's Bridge had a very good beginning. 5 Hail Marys away with speed. And to the outside, 7-2 off suit, came out running in third. Then Nicole's Song coming through and opening on the inside. Holiday Blaze is right alongside, close up in 5th, 3 lengths off the lead.
One is third.
And first
five,
is best
three,
right behind them,
one.
Followed by Princess Wesley. Toward the inside, Glacial Breeze is third last.
He got bet down to 2-1 to
Sky
one.
And Poetic Fan chalk. As they make their way
bet
to the back
chalk, stretch. Neil, bet the chalk. Now he's fourth on the inside,
quarter.
Down on the rail.
And 5 Hail
Don't
Marys
get pinned down there, Javier.
By 2 lengths. Laughlin's Bridge is second. To the outside, it's 7-2 off suit. Nicole's Song fourth along the rail, 3 lengths off the lead. Tracking them is Holiday Blaze. On the outside, Princess Wesley, and then first is best along the rail, who's now 5.5 lengths off the lead. Mm. Glacial Breeze is next, and then Ski Sky.
Got any
and
horse, Javier, now would be a good time to start
to
using it. He's third down on the inside.
Half mile,
3-5-1.
5 Hail Marys, and Eck in front. Laughlin's Bridge second to the outside as they enter the far turn. Princess Wesley circles up quickly now, and here comes Princess Wesley, strong and right behind the top two. Nicole's Song behind them in fourth. Then comes First Is Best, Glacial Breeze to the outside, and Holiday Blaze in their end of the stretch. Laughlin's Bridge, Princess Wesley on the outside.
Well, Craig,
five,
sorry.
Hail Mary's along the rail.
Well, here
Nicole
comes the one
song,
now making a move.
Right behind
Too
the
late.
Leaders. And then comes Holiday
late,
Blaze
Javier.
On the far outside. Laughlin's Bridge to catch. Princess Wesley not getting to her. Nicole's Song and First Is Best. It's Laughlin's Bridge to win it.
5-6-1. Finish third. So Nicoletti picked the winner again. See, I told you, go with Ron Nicoletti. And you said, oh, he don't know nothing. That wasn't a very impressive race, to be honest with you. I mean, he finished third, but, like, he just never menaced. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Are you depressed?
A little bit. I'm a little sad.
I bet your chronic Craig is sad. You're probably not sad because I don't think, you know this guy?
Yeah, I know him.
So, in other words, you're glad he lost.
No, I'm not saying that. He's a good guy. He's just a chronic. He comes to everything and enters everything and... I guess it's a good thing.
Steve Friedman says there's a brand of kosher wine called Carmel. Have a great vacation. Thank you, Steve.
I'm sure it's
Carmel,
great.
Like Carmel, you know.
Do you like Carmel? Carmel?
Yes.
You should try the Ben & Jerry's Carmel Sutra.
Oh, no, thanks.
It's good.
Flea says he doesn't eat meat because it's alive. What an ass clown. I checked. Plants are alive also.
Yeah, okay, whatever.
But do plants have feelings?
Maybe.
Feelings. Let's see. Here's one from Chris in Fort Lauderdale. To end all contention, I just swung into McDonald's and bought a double cheeseburger. It indeed has two slices of cheese. One on top of the first patty, one in between the two patties. Unfortunately, I ate the burger and I'm currently doubled over in pain. But anything for you, Uncle Neil says, with quiet dignity, Chris in Fort Lauderdale. Well, thank you so much for making the great sacrifice. Oh, my God. And now here's another story about this double cheeseburger. The chronic in Coco. Contradicting the earlier story that I read.
Okay.
Do you think the early one could have been wrong?
Maybe.
Sounded pretty authoritative. It looked like the Emmis. So we finished a non-menacing third there, you know. It looked, I don't know. Didn't look too good. Didn't look like a grade A effort. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I mean, you know, he ran, he stayed down on the rail, and then he made a little bit of a move there at the end to get third, but...
So what do we do next week? George and I going to pick the horse, or are you going to call in and pick the horse?
We'll see. I have no idea where I'm going to be, if I'm going to be alive. Who the hell knows?
Maybe in Germany?
Yes, please. So the chronic in Coco, Russell, says, not to contradict the Crane's Business Daily McDonald's story you read, but this is how it really happened at most Mickey D's outlets here in South Florida.
Okay.
Here's the Emmis, the story behind the story, allegedly. 5 or 6 weeks ago, the double cheeseburger disappeared from the dollar menu. Bad news for old schleppers like me who rely on that menu for a hit of meat and other tasty junk food once a week or so. Then about 2 weeks ago, the McDouble, two hamburger patties with only one slice of cheese, showed up on the dollar menu. The new thing tastes great, is perfectly fine. One slice of cheese per fast food meal is enough cholesterol for me, thank you very much. Fortunately, the suits at McDonald's seem to understand that a dollar menu with a reasonable selection is on it is the thing that brings in a good chunk of their customers. Hopefully, they'll keep it around for at least a few more years.
Yeah.
Now, I don't understand. How does that change from what the other story said?
I guess it didn't. No, it's the same story.
It's the same damn story. There's one slice of cheese on the double cheeseburger that's on the dollar menu.
Right. I think he said they basically just changed the name of it, right? It's not called the double cheese anymore. What do you call it?
The other story said the McDouble.
Yeah.
Two hamburger patties. Then that's what the other story said. Exactly the same, Russell.
There you go.
Love the show. Have a great weekend. The Chronic and Coco. Well, he just, one of those guys. He's got to be smarter than everybody else. Smarty pants.
Yeah.
Well, do you realize I'm going on vacation in about 9 minutes?
That's awesome.
It really is. I might not go anywhere, and then again, I might. I'll think about it. I'll give it some thought. I'll sit around and, twiddle my thumbs. Well, do I not, Save a lot of money if I stay here. Although I could be going to Woodbine every day and lose a lot of money.
Sure.
If I go to Berlin, I don't know if there's... I think there's a casino in one of the big hotels there.
What about Vancouver? They have gambling there?
Oh, yes. River Rock Casino. Nice little place. I've done pretty good there. That's the place where Paco insisted on playing the $5 Wheel of Fortune and he hit $2,000 on the wheel.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I'm screaming at him, no, don't do it. It's a killer. And he gets $2,000.
Well, if you go back to Vancouver, I stayed at this place called the Opus Hotel. It's awesome. And it's within walking distance of, some really good restaurants.
Oh, here you go. The fake Jim DeFeatus says, oh, poor Javier. First of all, it wasn't Javier. Bet the chalk, Neil, the chalk. Well, guess what? The chalk was the one, and we did bet it, and he didn't win. Idiot. See, that's what happens when you have so much fat. It, like, strangulates your the blood from flowing up into your brain.
Yeah.
That's the fat Jim DeFetis. Can you believe it's a little murky, but not too bad. Plus 9, 48 degrees here.
It's not bad.
Going to make it to 50, second day in a row.
I think it's 82 here.
No. Too hot. No, 82 is okay.
Yeah, that's not bad.
Now, when is the Marlins game tonight?
Yeah, they have a game tonight, tomorrow night, and then Sunday afternoon against the Mets all this weekend. Saturday's a 6 o'clock game, which is weird.
Oh, my God. I just got, and I talk about going on vacation on a sour note. I just got an email from guess who? Your close friend.
Okay.
Joe Bell.
Oh, really?
Have a great vacation. I'll call you sometime next week. I'll be on vacation next week, okay? Don't call me on vacation.
No.
And don't even consider an affirmative answer to that preposterous nonsense you suggested yesterday, Joe. The answer very clearly is no.
No.
I'm not going to bring it up on the air, but it just the flea knows what it is.
Are you sure?
Positive. Let me say it again. N freaking O.
No. No. No, 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 no.
Take out the scalpel and chop away someplace else.
O'Neill!
Oh.
It's day in Miami town.
Yes.
At 560 WQAM. Every time I see that retarded dimwit on my TV, he's President Dump. Republicans muscled in an inarticulate idiot. I don't know why they would want this guy, but now he's here. With President Thumb. President Dumpster.